Today is September 28th, 1997. This is an interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. My name is Brad Kurtzberg. We're in Kew Garden Hills, New York, USA, and the interview will be conducted in English. Today is September 28th, 1997. This is an interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. My name is Brad Kurtzberg. We're in Kew Garden Hills, New York, USA, and the interview will be conducted in English. Good afternoon, Mrs. Friedman.
Hi.
Could you please state and spell your name for us?
My name is Sarah Friedman, F-R-I-E-D-M-A-N, with an H on that, Sarah with an H.
And what was your name at birth?
Well, my Jewish name was Sarah, without the H. And at the time when I was born, my mother gave my name Agnes. In Czech, it's Gotta, G-O-T-T-A, Grunberger. G-R-U-N-B-E-R-G-E-R. That was when I was born.
And when and where were you born?
I was born in Irshava. You want to spell that?
Please.
I-R-S-A-W-A. With a, in Czech you make a, on top. Anyway, spelled in Czech. It was Czechoslovakia at the time. And I was born March 6th, 1929, probably at home with a hay band, with a
midwife?
Midwife.
Mm-hmm. And if I may ask, that makes you how old today?
68.
Tell me a little bit about your family. What was your father's name?
Well, my father's name was Elias Grunberger. My mother's name was Malvina. Her maiden name was Roth, R-O-T-H. I was one of seven siblings. My oldest brother was born in 1923. My older sister was born in 1924.
Now, their names are?
My oldest brother was Aaron. My sister was Mildred. In Czech, the names were a little different, but it doesn't matter any. And my second brother was Irving, who was born in 1926. Then I had a brother, Morris, who was born in 1928. Or maybe 27. I don't remember. I just know I was born in 1929, and there was 17 months between us, so it must have been the end of 27. And then I had a brother, Usher Anshul, his name was. He was born in 1930, and I had a younger sister, Blima, who was born in 1932, September 1st. Her birthday I remember, because that was always the first day of school in Czech. No matter even if it was on a Sunday, school started September 1st.
Tell me a little bit more about your father. What did he do for a living?
Well, my father was, his main occupation was, we had a lumber yard. He also, where I come from, that's the Carpathian mountains. Mm-hmm. And he used to buy off mountains and the wood, you know, the trees, cutting, whatever, and shipping. So that was his. We also had a wholesale grocery business. So he was a businessman, a very religious man. Of course, he was my father, so
right. That
goes without saying. He was very well liked and very influential. He lived in a small town. My mother was 11 years younger than him. And she was home. That's the way I guess it was in those days. Although she was a little bit involved in my father's business to the extent where when there was payroll and from the mountains, the workers came in, she would be with him in the office, which was not too far from the house. It was like the next building, so we had like a pathway with a, and she would go Friday afternoon or whatever day the paid day was. She would be there with my father. I guess, like today, must have been afraid to have so much money and these roughnecks, rough guys come in. So that's the way I remember it.
Is there a special memory of your father that you
recall? Oh, yes, a lot. He was, for instance, surprising, such a busy man. When he used to go up, this was like, you had to take the trains to go to where the wood, where the trees were being cut and the lumber being cut, whatever. So he would, every second week, he would take one of his children with a friend to and like an outing with him. And that was our biggest treat, to go with him up to the mountains. My mother would prepare for us all the food, whatever. And he was very involved, a very family man. My memories going back is every day when he used to go to synagogue, which he went twice a day with his boys. And my mother used to run to the window always and say, look at my boys. Someday I'm going to walk with my three girls like this, because we were younger yet. So he was very unusual in that respect, that he was extremely family-oriented, regardless how busy he was. He would learn with my brothers. He would see what their homework was, whatever. I never woke up to anything else except my father's learning, because in those, in our circles, before you start your day, you learn the Talmud. I never, ever remember waking up to anything else except my father's learning. And those are basically, I was very young when all this stopped, so that's about how much I want to talk about.
How about a special memory of your mother?
Well, I was very close with my mother. I was the fifth child, as you can see. And she had three big boys before she had me. My older sister was named for my grandmother, who died very young, my father's mother. So I guess she was more my father's girl, and I was completely my mother's pet. Also, my mother used to love gardening, flowers, and I was always an early riser. So we had a special morning hours all summer where I would just have time. She always used to say, this is my time with you. And when I look back today as a mother of two, and I probably appreciate it more now, that a mother of seven, she had her seven children in 10 years. My oldest brother and my youngest sister were only 10 years apart. No matter how much help you had, she had time for each and every one of us to be individuals. So she always used to tell me, the morning hours are yours and mine. Nobody disturbs us. So those are my most pleasant memories, looking back. And then, in Europe, things were different than here. We used to come home for dinner, for 2 o'clock. School started early, and we would come home 1 o'clock. It was from 8 to 1. So we had dinner meals. The daytime was the dinner. And those were always family meals. My father came home, unless he was out of town, which happened. But most of the times he tried, as I said, he used to go up to the mountains once a week, sometimes twice. Those days, we had dinner without him. But as a rule, we always had the daytime meal, all of us together. And this is something which children of today completely lack. What else would you like to know?
You mentioned you came from a religious home.
Very religious background.
Tell me what preparations for Shabbos and a typical Erev Shabbos would be like in your house.
Well, we lived in a small town, and everything was done at home. So it started really, I have to tell you a little funny story about this, that when my daughter was growing up and she came home once from school, they said it's very important to start to prepare for the Sabbath on Thursday. So she said in school, my mother starts on Wednesday, which is the truth because I was used to from home. You started on Wednesday preparing already for the Sabbath. You had to prepare the flour, we baked the challahs at home. And I wish with all my heart that every Jewish child should be able to have that feeling, to walk in Friday early morning, wake up to the smells of home baking and home cooking and preparations for your family life. I think this is such a... that I tried to instill this in my children, which I don't know how their houses are, whether they don't bake and things that much. But this is my warmest memories of home. Mm-hmm. Everything was cooked in the house and everything was prepared, and by the time Friday lunch came, the candles, everything was set, the table was set, and my father came home. And Thursday night was bath time. You know, everybody had to be bathed and everything. So really, preparations for the Sabbath started way earlier. And it was a very important function in the house.
Did you have a particular role, a task
oh,
that you
yes.
did?
Yes, everybody had tasks. I was the fifth, so I didn't have that many responsibilities. And I was very young, but I did have to dress my younger sister, see that her hair was done and prepare. We all had to do our own. We had maids, but we all had to do our own shoes for Shabbos, prepare everything. Everybody had to be busy with Shabbos. It was considered a mitzvah, which is a good deed, that you do something for the Sabbath, whether be it help for your mother or prepare your own things. But everybody had a responsibility that involved preparation for the Sabbath.
Tell me what a typical Shabbos meal would be like.
At home?
Yeah.
Well, being a big family, my father naturally sat at the head of the table. On one side sat my four brothers, on the other side my mother and the three of us. And we always had... that was the style at the time, I guess, or the necessity did it. We always had a Jewish girl in the house, which was probably from a poorer family. And she was considered one of the families. She was not adopted or anything. She was helping my mother. And she sat on the other side of the table. But she always sat with us on Shabbos. I remember one was with us until she got married, and the second one was until we went to Auschwitz, because towards the end we were not allowed to have Christian girls. So we had this Jewish girl always with us. And it started. My father came home from shul with the boys, and they were singing the zmiras, blessing the children, and eating the typical Shabbos meal, fish, soup, chicken, whatever. Zmiras, I don't know if you know that, that's the traditional singing, which my mother had an unbelievable voice, and not having television and all these things that the children today couldn't live without, that was a main entertainment. Before bedtime or in the afternoon, she would sing to us, and she was teaching us all these Jewish songs that are today, you don't even hear them. I wish I could remember them, but some of them I absolutely don't.
Is there one that you do particularly remember? Or?
Some of it.
Would you sing a little bit?
Not really.
No?
I couldn't do it now.
No.
But my children know. Mm-hmm. Because there was one song, all the Jewish traditions bring with it a lot of pain. So most of these songs are sad. And when we were children, we couldn't understand it. And my mother would sing it and say, that is the way life eventually becomes. You were not, little did she know, she did not have to teach us that life is not all of roses. But nevertheless, those were pleasant memories.
You mentioned that you came from a small town.
Yes.
Before the war started, before the Hungarians came in, how would you describe relations between Jews and Gentiles in Yeshiva?
Well, being from a small town and being from an influential family, sort of, most of my friends I had, let me not say most, I had quite a few Gentile friends, which turned out to be my closest friends when we were little, because they were neighbors. One of them was the druggist's daughter, the better class. We went to school together, and I never really realized when I was very little that they were anti-Semitic until the war came. And from one day of the other, when I was 12, and we had come back from hiding, we were hiding for about 3 months. And out of the blue, I was 12 years old, and I said, hi, I'm back. And she spit at me, and I came home devastated. I said, Ma, how could that be? We used to sleep together, and her mother knew that we were kosher, that I can only have in the morning from the bakery a roll, not from her house anything, before I went to school. She didn't talk to me. She just spat at me. She says, sweetie, that's the way life will be from now on. And after that, we realized how much anti-Semitism that there was. Of course, after that, when the Hungarian came, and which was in 1939, already my father's permits, it was called the IPAR. Every business in Europe had to have a license. Mm-hmm. And the license was taken away, but who knew? They brought from Hungary somebody to take over the business. They gave them the business, but of course he knew nothing about the business. So we happened to work with him very well. My father made with him off the record, like a quiet deal, that you just sit here and we'll pay you. We gave him a house for his family and him. And my father continued in the business until we went to the ghetto, really. But everything was supposedly not under his name anymore. It was confiscated and given over to this. His name was, I'm trying to remember. I really don't remember his name. He was with us for 4 years, and I don't remember his name anymore. Miklos something. He was not mean to us, but of course he did not mingle with us at all, except he was in the business. It was strictly. We were just lucky that he was a very stupid guy, and he just said, yes, Mr. Grünberger, I understand. You just do everything as long as I can live in comfort. So my father saw to it that he did live in comfort, and he was just supposedly in the background. But it was good for us because we lived next to the business, to the lumber yard, and he could move around and he was free to do everything as before.
You mentioned earlier that you went to school and with a lot of Gentile.
Yes, there was
girls.
No Jewish school for girls in those days, where I come from.
Right.
And that's exactly why it was so shocking that we were sitting in the same seats next to each other, and we were best of friends until the Hungarians influenced them. So I guess they must have hated us before too, only they had no chance to show it.
You attended public schools?
Public school.
Mm-hmm. How, were you still a student when the war broke out?
Yes, I was when the war broke out, when the, in our town in 1938, the Ukrainians came in. And for 6 months we were under the Ukraine, and the Czechs lost their republic. We became Ukraina. And that lasted about eight months, which made to us very little difference, children. I don't know what it did to my parents, but to us children it was just the fact that to certain towns we couldn't travel anymore because a new border opened, which was inconvenient for us because my grandfather lived in Munkács, which was 40 kilometers from us, and the border was before that. They became Hungary right away, and we were Ukraina. And the schools changed. They became Russian schools right away. That lasted till 39, and then the Hungarian came in. And then these schools changed, and you had to change to Hungarian schools. So in that 1 year, I was in Czech school, and Russian school, and Hungarian school, which didn't last long, because the Hungarian school, nobody spoke Hungarian where I came from. So they had to settle for a Russian school. So I went to Russian school for the rest of the 3 years until the Germans came, and then Jews were not allowed in school.
Did you have any ideas as to what you wanted to do at that time before the war broke out?
No.
Or what studies you wanted to pursue?
No, because I was... When the war really broke out, I was like 10 years old. By the time we felt we had, who was thinking of way down the road what's going to be? At least no, I didn't. I don't know about anybody else. Certainly my parents did not discuss long-term things because we started living from day to day. Unfortunately, my mother was born in Poland, and that brought on the fact that we were affected very early. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned before, my father did have influence, and he knew way ahead that they will send my family to Poland because she was born there, which was not fair. He kept on arguing. That's why it lasted longer than most, because my mother really was brought up in Hungary. She was the oldest child of six. And my grandparents were in Poland, but they wanted their daughter to have experience of the world. So since she was like 12, they lived in a very, very tiny town. There was not even 10 Jews. There was no minyan. So the big girl they sent to Hungary to an aunt, to be brought up in a bigger city. So she knew Hungarian and we didn't, even though she was born in Poland. So my father was arguing this point, which lasted for a while, but on the end we did have to go into hiding until he did work it out. We were never sent really to Poland. But for 3 months, all of us were in separate things.
Now, you said your father had influence.
Political influence.
How did he have that influence, and what kind of influence did he
have? I don't know how much you would have to be European to know that in those days, money talk is number one. Number two, he was in some position in politics, and that he was like a town councilman, whatever. So everybody knew him and respected him. So the mayor and all these people came to tell him, Grünberger, Mr. Grünberger, be careful, you're on this and this list. So right away he knew. So what happened, as I said, that they came to tell him that 3 days from now they are coming to take you, nothing will help you. I was 12 years old by then. And I always had trouble with my ears. And being in a smaller town, I used to be taken to the next town, to a bigger town that had a specialist for examination of my middle ear, whatever infections that I had. So they woke me up one morning. This I remember distinctly. Around 4:30. I got dressed, and my little 10-year-old sister, she was 9. They dressed her, and they gave me whatever money and my father, and they put on a kerchief on me with a lot of cotton on my ear, and my father told me, "Suri, I'm putting you on this and this train, and you're going till Berexas. If they stop you, you just say that you don't know nothing. You are going to Dr. Karachani," his name was. "You have an appointment, and nobody could come with me, and I'm afraid to travel by myself." So I took along my little sister. In Berexas, they did stop me on the train, because the Hungarians, they were called, they had, like here, the policemen, but they had very big heads with black feathers, and they were called the tollas, whatever. So they did stop me. They said, "Where are you going, girls?" And I explained to them exactly the way my father taught me. I was scared to death, but I did not say an extra word. That's all I said. Kept on repeating, "I'm going to this and this doctor. You can come with me," but the whole thing. One of my aunts lived in this town, and she waited for us by the station and put us in a, not in a car, but in a wagon, you know, in a, with horse and wagon. And they took us to the next station. They were afraid to, maybe they are watching these two children, and maybe we are, they put us on another state, to another station, the next town, and they sent us to Nyíregyház, which was in deep Hungary. My father had a brother there, mm-hmm. and he had no children. So we were staying with him for 3 months. He gave us different names, and we were there for 3 months. The rest of the family, all of them were hidden out. One of my brothers, my sister, and my mother went to the woods with my father. He made arrangements there with a Christian family. My sister refused to go anywhere without my father, so this way my father could see her. My father was free to go because the business could not go on without him, so they kept him free. Within those 3 months, he went up to Budapest, and whatever, I guess, money can buy anything in Europe, he bought us all papers back. And after 3 months, one of his nieces was getting married, which in Europe, children were not invited to weddings. But we all came to this wedding, and we had a reunion.
Okay. We're going to end tape one here, and we'll pick this up with tape number two.
Okay. I appreciate it.
We're beginning tape number two, interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. It is September the 28th, 1997. Mrs. Friedman, when we left off, you said that for 3 months you were in hiding with relatives in another town, and then you had this big reunion at a wedding. getting back to the 3 months that you spent, tell me what your life was like during that time.
Well, fortunately, very normal. I had an uncle who was childless, my father's brother. My father's family was a very, very close-knit family. Just to put it on the light side, my mother always used to say, I remember this, that there are families that are like fairful, which is a pasta that falls apart because you make it with fat. Then there is spaghetti, also a pasta. But you take a spoon of pasta and everything goes one after. You cannot take one piece of pasta. He says, Daddy's family is like a pasta. But then actually used to prepare us that in the world not everybody is like that. So we were very, very close-knit family, and my uncle did not know what to do for us. He would take us to the movies, and he was an Orthodox man. He would not go in, but made sure that these two little girls had seats. He would go before and set us down and enjoy it and wait for us. He was a big businessman also. He had a village emerge, like here, tropical fruits, which was a big thing in Europe. They used to say that an orange you eat, either the orange is rotten or you are rotten. But he would bring us home oranges and fix things that you don't see in Europe, because that was his business. He didn't know what to do. And even my aunt always tried to keep us in a normal atmosphere. She would bring in, she would let us bring in children to play, even though this house was a childless. And you know, when you don't, you're not used to that. We were young kids. At night, we would cry ourselves to sleep. We wanted our mother, our father. We were used to a house full of children. And my uncle would read us stories. And I was a bigger girl, already 12, and I would say, you can go to shul. I'm not afraid. He says, that's exactly what I want. Don't want. You don't have to be afraid. I'll never let anybody touch you. During the day, we were not allowed to go out. He did not. Because he always said, if somebody will come and I'm here, you don't have no fears. I will answer for you. You don't know nothing. He gave us a different name. You just tell your name. And so during the day, we were always indoors. There was they had a big house. In that yard, there was another family that had children. You can go to their house. You can play by them. But you are not to go out. So that's the way the 3 summer months went. Pleasant. Mm-hmm. But when we went from there in Berexas, as I said before, my father's a niece, one of our cousins, got married, and we all met at this wedding. I remember my mother bought for the couple, which this cousin of mine had no mother, only a father. It was my father's sister's daughter. And my mother bought her the candlesticks, silver candlesticks. And my cousin said, look what my mother brought you. And we all said, look what my mother got us herself. We were children, but it was such a treat to us that we were finally back together. And my father said, we're all going back home together, which we did.
During that 3 month period, did you have any contact with your parents at all?
Not directly, no. My uncle, whether it was true or not, would always tell us, your father called. They did not have a phone at home, only in the business. And neither did we. We also just had a phone in the business. So he would come in at night. Whether it was true or not, I will never know. But he always would say, oh, you know what? Your father called today, and he said you should better behave, because if I complain, whatever. He made it into a fun vacation. He tried very hard. And for my little sister, it definitely was just a vacation. For me, too, I was not unhappy, and I was not afraid, because I was so sure that he will protect me. I was afraid for my other two brothers. Two of my oldest brothers were away in a yeshiva in Papo, it was called, which was like very, very far from us. My father did make it there. When he was in Budapest working on the papers, he made a trip to see those two boys because he was afraid for them, because that could have been found out where they are. Also, that yeshiva guaranteed that they would protect them. They also, everybody had influence somehow. whatever they would, and they did. Whether they were looking for them there, I also don't know. So, but my other two brothers, Irving and Moshe, no, Irving wasn't Papa, Moshe and Usher Rancho, for them I always was afraid because they were hidden, one in Munkach by an uncle who also couldn't go out during the day, no place. And my other brother was not a very strong boy at the time, so he was also hidden by a Christian family. And that probably did hinder my mind a little bit. But most of the time I was not thinking, I was not in real danger really while I was there. My danger was only until getting there. And I look back all the time. I was 12 years old, responsible for a little girl of 9. And I was not afraid to take this journey. I had to go through a border by myself with her, during the night traveling. I never thought to be afraid, just to get there. That was like a goal.
After this reunion at the wedding, your family, did they return home?
Yes. After we all went home. And we had papers, legal papers, however it worked, I don't know. But my father had legal papers. We were free to be the... I mean, we still went back to school. September, we went back to school, normal. We were not made feel in the town as we were back to normal.
Were there any other significant occurrences?
Well, we knew we were, first of all, my mother's parents still lived in Poland, and 4 brothers and a sister she had that were all single at home. And they were right away, went into hiding to Lemberg, to the next big town. And one day we got a letter with a shliach, how do you say a shliach, with a messenger that they hired and sent over. And she naturally wrote what they are going through. She's already, my grandmother wrote to my mother that a whole year she is in underground. One of my uncles was a member in the underground and he was outside and bringing them in little things. And my mother was reading and rereading this letter and we were crying, all of us, and then my father said, that is inhuman, that cannot be. Little did we know that it was. And nobody from my mother's family is alive, except she, 2 of her cousins that lived near where we lived. You will see on the end, I have a picture of that end. The rest of them were all killed, not in Auschwitz. They were caught, we heard from people. And of course, my mother was never aware of that. She was waiting for the war to be over. And naturally, because as children, my mother had a passport with 2 children. That's the way it was. It wasn't like here that you need every child a separate. She had a passport to take along. And twice a year, she went home. And I have been there a few times. I remember my grandparents with a lot of love and with a lot of affection. And she used to say, oh, God, let this war be over. I can't wait to go home. And we all hoped for that, which of course never happened. Other than that, we lived normal till the Germans came in.
So, under the Hungarians, between 1941 and 1944, you were still able to go to school?
I was able to go to school. We had yellow... We had to wear yellow munduets on our clothes. In other words, we had to be identified as Jews. But we went to school still, till about 6 months before the Germans came in, I think.
No.
That the last year I never finished, so then I remember.
Do you recall when you had to start wearing the Star of David on your clothing?
And when we came back from hiding, we had to wear already our yellow.
How, do you remember the first time you walked outside wearing it?
I don't remember the first time. I just remember that I didn't think it was so terrible. Because my mother used to prepare us. If they laugh at you, if they throw stones, go on the other side. And I always said, they knew I'm Jewish before too. It didn't dawn on me that this would make a difference to them. And the Hungarian gendarmerie, the police, we as children, when we saw them, we anyway ran into anybody's house that was next. So we hid from them regardless of the sárga csillag, regardless of the patch on our clothes. So to me as a child, I don't remember to be petrified from it. Maybe my parents were, because my mother always used to prepare us. When we went to school, she would send us off. Please, you see somebody throws at you, you run on the other side. So I don't remember that frightened me, no. I knew I was Jewish before, and they know. And it didn't dawn on me at the age of 12 and 13 that I would be discriminated all of a sudden until I lived it. Right. So why would this little thing change it? And again, I had very little to do with. Very few German families came. They did not. Hungarian, real Hungarian. Only the ones that got the businesses. Those are the ones. So the ones that we were affiliated with did not really bother us.
Now, until the Germans came in, were the shuls still open? Was religious practice still free and accessible to
you? Well, it was accessible. But it was already like in the dark. My father was afraid to come home, and you know, the Jewish services. But they did go to shul as far as I can remember. Mm-hmm. I don't remember that the shul was closed only when the Germans came in.
Do you recall your father or any other members of the Jewish community, what their response was to having to wear the yellow star or any other restrictions that were placed on Jews?
I'll tell you, we had a very bad experience in 1942, after we were already back home. So it must have been like the end of 42. My father had three brothers in Munkács, and my grandfather was dead already. And he used to say, thank God my father is dead. And we couldn't understand why he said it. Because his youngest brother, for some reason, they were also wealthy merchants. For some reason, he was arrested. I guess something they didn't like. They didn't have a reason to arrest. And they took him. It was called the Kemel Harito. It was like a prison in Munkács. And, of course, my other two uncles called my father right away, and my father took the bus and went right away there. And those three brothers somehow got him out after like a day and a half. I was too young, and I cannot tell you what the reason was that he was taken in, but they did get him out. But I remember my father coming home and telling my mother that every rib in his body was broken. That's how they beat him up. And this was his youngest brother. He was in his late 40s, in his middle 40s maybe, or early 40s. But yet it was his baby brother, and being very religious, he said, nobody knows who is next, because there was no reason for this. I guess it involved a lot of money or what, how to get him out, I don't know. And he started to fast every Monday and every Thursday till 2 o'clock, that this should never happen to another Jew. Whether the sárga csillag did it because my father also had to wear a yellow star, I really don't know.
In 1944, things changed dramatically in your town.
Yes.
What was the first?
44 or the end of 43, I'm trying to know. It was the beginning of 44, like probably. Around January, I don't remember exactly when the Germans came in. But when the Germans came in, overnight, you were afraid to go to shul. They started most of the time to daven at home. And that was a very big sacrifice in most Jewish people. Of course, my family, my immediate family, we never felt, God forbid, hunger or anything, because That's the way it was. I don't know how my father got it. Everything was already rationed, and for Jews were not allowed to buy this or buy. We never lacked anything. We had everything the same way. But when the Germans came in, I remember always saying, oh, whenever my father would buy out on the black market and prepare everything, who knows till then we can go out of the house. And we hardly ever did go out. We did not really leave the house much. We had a big yard. And that's when everybody started to be very scared. It didn't last long because the Germans came in the very beginning of 44. And April, they took us already to the ghetto. So, and we started hearing that, they take away. They did one morning, I remember. My father came home, he said he cannot go to shul anymore. Not because the shul was closed, but because in the street they caught a few Jews and they cut off their beards and they beat them an inch of their life for no reason. So they stopped going to shul like the last, I don't remember how many days, but I know one thing, Purim is 4 weeks before Passover. Right. And that was one of the biggest treats for children. And we used to take, you take shalom, like food packages, especially in the town, to poor people. Today it's a fashion to make it fancier and fancier. In my time it was really for poor people. And that year, my mother did not let us take it to nobody, and it was the most disappointing. We still were young kids, most of us. Of course, we couldn't understand why not. But I remember that we had the big feast, and we all stayed home, and usually people came to bring us and exchange goodies, and nobody came, and we couldn't go out anymore. So that was like when we really felt the thing that we are not free anymore.
What else do you recall about the time period between January and April of 1944?
Just being afraid always. Everybody was afraid already. My father and mother already spoke in very low tones. We shouldn't understand. The children should know. At one point, my oldest brother, who was already 21, my father came home one day and he said that somebody sold him papers for my sister and my brother, she was 9. Oh, she was going out with a boy from Berexas, which was the next town. And they were getting engaged just as the Germans came in. And they did get engaged through the phone because you couldn't travel anymore, you could almost walk it. But of course you didn't walk, but they never made it to the town. Jews were not allowed to go on trains or buses or wagons or anything. So the whole engagement, everything was done over the phone. Wow. My father had a phone in the office, as I said. So my sister was engaged, and my older brother, the two of them, my father bought papers, Irish, different name. They should go to Budapest and be on Aryan papers as Gentiles. And my sister refused to go. She started crying. She wants to get married when this is over, and it has to be over, and it cannot go on like this. And my father said, you are right. We should all be together forever. So whatever it was, however he got to have it, it was never carried out. And then my mother said, I'm not letting one child go. Either they go together. I would let the two of them, whatever happens, let them be there until this blows off. Nobody thought that this will really happen. That's one thing you have to give the Germans credit for. They hid it as well as they could. So in your wildest dreams, you did not dream that this can become a reality. So I remember that argument, I remember more than that, was hidden from children. And I was one of the younger ones. So, okay. Till Passover, we had a beautiful Passover. I cannot say that we were just very annoyed as children. We missed all the parties. My sister, you know, the first engagement in the house. So that we resented. We knew the boy already because he used to come before that already to the house. Which, fortunately or not, they met after the war and they eventually did get married.
When the Germans came in, did you notice any additional changes in the attitudes and actions of your neighbors?
We did not have neighbors anymore. We did not go out very rarely. As I said, we were not allowed to schools anymore. My Gentile kids, you got up and like, here is graffiti. They made holes in your... you know, and you're, when you walk into that, in at least in my house, we had a big entrance from the street into the yard. We were all walled in. So in, they made holes in the wall and through things. So we did not have any more. They would come in through the fence, throw stones and scream from outside. You Jews go to hell, whatever. But it was, thank God, it did not last long because we were still a family. I know we did not have nothing to do with the outside world anymore, especially not the children. My father did go out. He did conduct his daily business, I guess the best way he could, I don't know. Luckily, my father was never beaten or anything in front of us. There were Jews that did go to synagogue and whatever, and they were usually either stone beaten or whichever. But that I never remember. As I said, my uncle was almost beaten to death, not my father, thank God. I only remember him as this very handsome, very good man. Till Auschwitz. I don't remember him being, he had his beard. Till we came to the ghetto.
So under the Germans, you have a situation with a lot more tension.
No question.
Was food still readily available at this point?
I don't know. In the outside, everything was rationed. But we had everything. How it... I guess my parents, my father prepared everything. I don't know. We had everything. We baked still every week. We had enough bread, and whoever came to the house, my mother shared, because, you know, that was a big thing, that is a big thing by Jews, to share everything. So as far as I can see, we were never hungry. We had everything till the last minute. I don't know about other people. We were, even between Jews, we were very little involved with other families in my town. I cannot remember how it was in the bigger towns, but we come from a, it's not a village, it's called a Kösség. It was like the central little town for the villages. Mm-hmm. All the offices for this whole, for let's say, for about 25 villages was in Irshava. It was like the Kösség. But we had, by the Germans, we had absolutely no contact with outside world.
Did there come a time when a ghetto was formed in Irshava?
Yes. Pesach ended on a Shabbos. My father came home. I think he did go to shul with the boys, or he did somewhere they dammed. I remember him coming home in the morning and saying, I think this is it. We will have to go to the ghetto. Tomorrow they're forming a ghetto. Maybe 2 days before he already knew. And my mother, as a rule, she, you know, after Passover at night, you put away all the dishes and everything. And she said, very fast, let's make Abdallah, because I have to put everything away. And my father said, you know what, my dear, don't put everything away. Who knows if we will need it. And my mother was arguing, of course we will need it. And also, like, certain food items like sugar and salt and things she would put away in a pattern for next year, because to acquire Passover things was very hard. She says, who knows, maybe it will still be war years, this I have, I'm putting away. And he said, I can't believe you're doing that, my dear. And my mother argued till the last minute. We put away that Passover like any other year. And sure enough, in the morning, 6 o'clock, they woke all of us up. I guess my father was up all night with my mother. Or maybe my older siblings too. I don't know. Us, the younger children, they woke up at around 5:30, I guess. And said, you have to be ready. We all had prepared a small valise with like maybe a week's stuff, underwear, whatever. And my father said, in the morning we're leaving. Which what happened is they made a ghetto in Irshava, which included the big shul where my father didn't even daven. He did not belong. He belonged there, but he davened in a shtibl, in another small shul. But again, I guess they had friends. One family gave us a room. And while we were packing, my father came back, I don't know from where, but he said to my mother, you are not going. I have papers that you are sick, and you can stay home alone. This way, and I will be able to come out every day. I think it was more that they knew nobody can take his place, because he did a lot of businesses in the town. So my father was... And my mother agreed. She will stay home, and my sister was 19, and she will cook for whatever. She will oversee us. So the 7 of us went into the ghetto. My father took us, and he came right by. He went out every day. He came every morning, saw to it, brought us food from home. My mother, I guess, cooked for us. I don't remember. You know, I was a kid, unhappy, miserable. And probably in those few days, we were not as miserable as you can think, because we were so hopeful that this is like a fun thing. Maybe we were too little. I don't know. Anyway, my mother was out there for about a week. My father used to come every night that she's crying. She doesn't want to be home. He doesn't know what to do. This is very good. This way we have what to eat. We are better off. But finally, my sister said, I don't blame her. Let her come and be with us. So after, I know that we were taken to the ghetto on an early Sunday morning, and for Shabbos, she was already with us. So when she came, she says, this is the happiest day of my life. We all slept on the floor. I don't know if we even had blankets, but I know that for my mother, they gave not a mattress, probably like straw or something. My mother slept on something. We all slept on the bare floor, and we didn't complain. We were children, youngsters. But we were happy to have her, and she said she is never going back without us. Every day, another woman came. Oh, Mrs. Grunberger, can I have your sewing machine? When you'll come back, and if ever you come back, I give it back to you.
Okay, we're going to end tape 2 here and pick this up with tape number 3.
Oh, good.
We're beginning tape number 3, interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. It is September the 28th, 1997. Mrs. Friedman, when we left off, we were still in your hometown. It was 1944, and there was a ghetto formed there. And you mentioned that all of the smaller towns
were coming in here.
Right. How long were you in the ghetto
there? We weren't long. We might have been, I mean, I really don't remember exact dates, but it could have been maybe 3 weeks, something like that.
And roughly when was the ghetto formed?
The day, it was exactly April 13 or 14, something like that.
And was this?
And before, and by the first week of May, no. It was formed April 12th, and about 10 days later, we went to Shoyovich. They came in the morning, they put us all in cattle cars, and they said, they told us, we're going to another ghetto. It took only about a day, and we came to Munkács, and Munkács was a brick factory, it was called the Shoyovich factory. We got like a corner of a house there, of one of the buildings, like offices, I guess, and that was for my family. We happened to lock out there, because I had, as I said before, three uncles in Munkács, and one of my uncles, however he did it, he got papers that he was bringing a medication to people. So he brought us extra food. And we saw him, so which was a treat. We did not, other than that, we got rations every day, which of course it was maybe not so hard on us children as on my parents. So my father every day went, when this, my uncle came through, they made up a time, when he's coming in, and he packed all his medication for this and for this. It was in those days, somehow in Europe, everything, I think till this day, you schmier, you fuhr, you give something. So they did come in every day for about 10 days. And then they caught on, one of the Germans, and I took my second uncle to that same Kemal Harito. And my father was already in the ghetto, he certainly couldn't do nothing for him. They beat him and they mistreated him, something terrible. They didn't think he will ever come out. But just about 2 days before we left, they sent in a shaliach, a messenger, to tell my father that they let him out, and they are also already in a ghetto. They are in a different, in Munkács, there were two teglagyar, brick factories. So my three uncles were in the other Tegla factory, which was, I think, called the Kalush factory. So we were in the Shoyovich. So we were glad that he was out. After the war, I learned from my cousins that he was almost dead when he came. He was brought home on a stretcher. But nevertheless, he went to Auschwitz. So after that, life became like for everybody else there. We were not no more Grünberger, we had to obey, and my father still had his beard. They did not touch him, they respected. He got more respect maybe than others, but he stayed out of their way. They did not penalize him for my uncle's actions, which at that time was the biggest thing. My mother, who was sickly already by now, she had a thrombosis on her legs. So, of course, we always worried about her. But she had a little better place to sleep. She had where to stretch out. And as I said, my sister was 19, and she was doing everything for the family. We all tried to be good. The kids, we ate whatever they gave us. Didn't have to be our favorite foods or whatever. But we weren't long in the ghetto. In the ghetto, we were till sometimes in May, so like maybe 4 weeks altogether.
How did you occupy your time during those 4 weeks?
What were crying and sitting and beating on each other, whatever, like children do. We were very confined. We were allowed in the ghetto, as a matter of fact, we were allowed to go within this. This was a big, I would say like here, let's say a block, a city block square, and we were allowed within that territory. And we, during the day, maybe went out, whatever there was. We had some books that we brought along, probably, but no activities, so to speak. Or we were fighting with each other, I guess. I look back, I couldn't tell you what I did. I just know. Most of the times we were scared because, oh, don't go here and don't go there, and if you see the chanders. So it didn't last long enough to train yourself to do something. It was every day. Or maybe tomorrow we didn't know. We would certainly was the most unknown future. We did not know what's going to happen from here. Somehow, while my uncle was coming in, this uncle of mine had a radio. In wartime, like towards then, the radio was still a big thing. They confiscated them. Somehow he hid his. He had a radio. He also was in America at one time. He came, he was visiting here as a young man, so he understood a little English, this particular uncle of mine. And he used to bring us news, oh, it's almost over, and do is over, and dart is over, and that's what every day, that's what the talk was. My father would, they did that in one corner, they had minyan. My father would come home, you know, this uncle's name was Yosef Martche. Yosef Martche said that it's only a question of hours, it's only a question. But those hours stretched into another year, so who knew? But that's how we occupied us, probably treading on hope.
You mentioned that people still held their own minion
in the ghetto. We had them. They had a minion. They did not have a sefer, but they didn't like unionism.
Do you know or recall what happened to the Sefer Torah from the synagogue?
Well, what happened, I don't know. But we went back after the war, and of course the synagogue was a movie theater. So.
Right. Was Shabbos still special in the ghetto? Were you still able to have some kind of celebration?
Probably my parents made it different than the weekday. I really don't think we had chicken or fish, but it was. We didn't do things that we did during the day. We knew we were not allowed to write or read, you know, whatever.
Right.
We did hold Shabbos. My mother had candles, believe me. They probably didn't take enough food, but they took enough candles along, so she did. And at home, my mother lit, I don't remember, maybe like 15 candles. Because as soon as the war started, you know how it was. Oh, this one was six, so for this one an extra candle. So she lit a lot of candles. I don't think in the ghetto she did not have her candelabra. So, no. By the way, when my mother stayed home, and my father used to come. So during one night, we had a, what do you call this? A well in the yard. The whole town used to come to us for water. It was the best water in town. And it was built like a little house above it. So in that attic there, my father put away all my mother's silver, my sister's, trousseau. And after the war, we always said, oh, I would just like to go home since I don't have anything from home. Really, no pictures, no practically nothing. We always, but of course it was Russian, we never could go home. Okay. So they did, I remember what my mother did is they cut a potato in thick slices, made little holes, and put in the candles, and that's how she lit the candles, wow, in the ghetto. But candles she brought along. What they thought, I guess they didn't have the traveling lighters like they have today. Mm-hmm. So that's what, yes, there was Shabbos, and we didn't get dressed up because we didn't have that much. We were only allowed to take everybody one hand luggage from home, so I guess we didn't have Shabbos clothes anymore, these sort of things. But it was a difference. Shabbos was Shabbos, and weekday was still weekday. Till we went into the cattle cars again.
you said you were in the Munkacsa ghetto for about 3-4 weeks.
Yeah, must have been about more like 3 weeks, not more than that.
What stands out in your mind most about your time there?
The darkness. There was no lights. You had to schnell go to sleep because then you don't know. We did not have beds. I remember everybody had their spot where they stretched out to sleep. And we had to do that while daylight was still on. Because there were no lights. They shut off the electric completely. And I guess that was the most frightening thing because we didn't have electricity already. And I guess the whole thing, the water shortage, we did not have. We had to go in the morning to get water. And, you know, religious rituals are when you get up, you have to wash your hands. And we had to wait until my father brought a ration. Those things probably stand out more, being brought up, that was so important, that we had to give this up. It was almost like giving up your rights to humanity. With my young mind. Looking back, it wasn't the worst thing, but at that time, I thought that was a very horrible experience, a frightening experience, maybe, I should say. Anyway, that's what stands out mostly. And that we ate sitting on the floor, which by Jewish people, they only do that after death, you're not supposed to. But we did sit on the floor. We had no table to eat, so like my mother, they put together a few bricks, and she would put food there. So this sort of thing, it stands out in my mind that we were just struggling, and we thought that's the worst thing. Coming from a comfortable home, where you had, I did not have my own bedroom, but I shared it with my two sisters. We had this, the girls had an extra bedroom. So coming from that sort of home into this was a scary experience. Mm-hmm. I do remember being very annoyed and probably saying things I shouldn't have said even to my parents. Why didn't we go in hiding? Some people did go in hiding, although, especially from our vicinity, 1 or 2 days later, they were all caught and brought in, all beaten up and bloody. And my father used to say, I did the intelligent thing. I did not hide out. I don't know whether it was the right choice or not, but it definitely was his choice.
Tell me about the circumstances, what happened when you left the ghetto.
Well, I don't know whether it was more scary or just the unknown, like. But my parents kept us very calm. We were put into really inhuman. We were put in, like, into cattle cars where we had to stand up. There was no room to sit down. As I told you before, my mother was already sickly. She had a thrombosis in her leg. She was 39 years old and the love of my father's life. And my father would pick up one of us that my mother should be able to sit and stretch out her legs. He kept on saying, keep my mommy's leg up. So it wasn't a humor. And they kept on saying, oh, but you're going to a better place. There was on each wagon 2 SS, maybe they were Wehrmacht, I don't think they were SS, 2 German soldiers. I think they must have been Wehrmacht. And they would say, it will be over soon, you're going to a better place, you're going to go to, the young people will go to work. He kept on telling us this. We were given once a day, I remember water to drink. I don't remember about the food. Really, I don't. I would have to ask my sister, which I neglected to ask. She probably would remember. But my parents took along while my mother was home, and we were in the Arshever ghetto. She would take milk and cook it to become hardened and cool it and cut it in like dots, not dots, kotskos, squares. And she would give each one of us in the morning, she made a whole bag of this, each one of us in the morning, one of those things to suck on until we consumed it. And she would sit, we didn't like it so much. So she would tell us, this will give you strength for the day. So I remember her giving these things for us on the train yet. You have to have the strength to survive. You have to have. So I don't remember being very hungry. I know we got water in the morning. I also know we did not have a bathroom. And that was just unbelievably terrible for us. But there was in one corner, you had to go through all these people's squeeze, and there was like a bucket where you could do your thing in front of all these, everybody else. And it lasted about, I think we were in these wagons 2.5 days. There were only very little windows with iron bars. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, we're all tall people. My father was a tall man. He would always look out. He says, oh, we're going to nice places. It's green outside. It was the beginning of May. It won't be so bad. We'll get out of here. Just let's already get out of here. Well, we did get out. We got to Auschwitz. It was during the daytime. And they opened the doors. And as I said, I had a 10-year-old sister and a 12-year-old. My brother was almost 13. He was 13. And my mother held on to these two children. Says she's not letting them go with us, because they might take us to work. So she said to me, what do you want to do? I was 14 and a half. I said, I want to go with you. And my father said no. I don't know what he knew. I don't think he really knew. I think what he really had in mind, I'm pretty convinced, that he wanted me to, he did not want my older sister to be alone. I think that's what it was, that if we are two, we'll somehow support each other, which turned out to be right. A right decision. I was tall, as young as I was one of the youngest between the people that, between the survivors. I'm really in the youngest group. But I was tall, and I had no problems going on the working side. So when we got off the wagons, that's all that my father said. No, you're going with Monsi. And a European child never even thought of disobeying or questioning the judgment of a parent. My father said to go, I will go. And there were these men that helped us off. They had already these striped uniforms. And they, I know now, and hindsight, you know, they were the Polish Jews that were there already very long. And they kept on saying, don't, just leave the mother, don't go with the mother, you know, like they were instructing us. And maybe that gave my father the clue, I don't know. My mother was taken to the left side with my sister and brother. And that was the last time I saw her. Now my father with the three boys, which also my 16-year-old brother, was not a very strong, we all are tall and healthy people, well-built people, but he was more on the delicate side, I would say. And he wanted to go with my mother, and my father also insisted, you're coming with me. My mother has enough, her foot hurts her. So my three brothers, my older three brothers, went with my father too, also to the working side. Now, at that time, we stood side by side, the men in one, but we could see each other. Mm-hmm. And my father kept on looking for us and saying, eat, being we are religious, you have to promise me to eat everything they give you. You have to be strong. Of course, we didn't even answer him, but it turned out that when we came to, we started marching, and we marched in separate ways already, the men separate from the women. Now, they took us towards a room. Nobody was allowed to ask anything, or really, and the funniest thing is, you look back, nobody asked. You were so trustworthy. Everybody wasn't religious, like I would say I trusted in God, but there were people that are not religious. Who did they trust in? Why didn't they say, I am not going? But I guess at this point we could not say no because there were dogs with them. They had big dogs with them. And they took us to, it looked like showers inside. They said they're taking us to fertility, what is the English word that they're supposed to disinfect you, like, you know?
From, like, lice or?
From whatever. Mm. They took us into a room. We had to get undressed naked. And then everybody started to protest. So one guy came in with this rubber thing. Nobody to talk. So, of course, everybody got undressed. Only our shoes we could keep. We could stay in our shoes. And then came they took us to a next room naked, and they shaved us right away, completely. It was hard for me to recognize my sister right away. But, of course, we held on to each other. Then they took us to a next room and shaved the rest of our bodies, wherever we had hair. And they sprayed us with something, we don't know what, and we were supposed to go into a shower room. So somehow we got scared. And we all huddled together. We must have been there 500-600 girls, women and girls. And we huddled together, but I remember again, this guy gave one yell and everybody, and sure enough, that's all it was like, as we were passing, water ran on us. We had just had to pass through. We came out, everybody got one dress. No underwear, no nothing, whatever, some kind of a dress. I don't recall. I remember it was like a blanket thing it looked. That's, as we walked out, we started marching. They put five in a row, and they counted us out, and they took us to, it was called Zeelager. We were in Birkenau now. Which one is about close to 3 kilometers from Auschwitz. It is called still Auschwitz, but this was the lager that was made in a hurry for all these, for the last year's work. All the crematoriums were in this part. Now, when we got here, we were assigned to Zeelager 18. Was number 18. We came in, we got a bunk. 14 girls to a bunk. The bunk was made like a wooden platform. It was two. And 14 on top, 14 on the bottom. Well, this is where you're sleeping. And we started to say, who? And they said, all of you. So we had to on the side, we had to line up. That's how we slept. If one had to turn, everybody had to turn. So that's, we figured this will last a day. Again, by now we were so scared. We saw the wires outside. They told us, oh yes, as we were walking, they were kept on explaining, do not touch anything. Everything is electrical. If you will touch it, you drop dead on the spot. Well, 2 or 3 big shots did try, and they did fall back right there. So that taught us the lesson right away. And one of them had a sister in the marching, and she said, she started screaming for her sister. She got a slap on me, so we saw right away where good things we won't have here. In the morning, we were woken up, that we went to sleep. We did not get any food. I don't think we got anything. Hungry we were not. The next morning we were woken up around, must have been before 5, because 5 o'clock, Zeelappel started. We were taken out. Naturally, we did not get undressed, so we did not have to get dressed in the morning. Some of American children would love that. We came out and we were lined up 5 in a row straight. And it was, you know, they called out names at the time. We each got a number. We were not tattooed. We just had a number, and my number was, I have it written down. I think it's 4082 or 8242. 4882. I will tell you later exactly I have it written. And my sister's was the next. Hers was 44. And as we are standing there, the first 3 days, on the other, these barracks were made, so here was a barrack and here, 18, whatever it was. And we were in the Zeelager. And on the other side, the men were being counted. And my father started calling our names. And we saw my father and my three brothers. Okay. First, we didn't recognize him because I showed you the picture. His beard was shaved. And my brother's pants, which they never had very big ones, but still. And they were in these striped uniforms. And my sister started screaming, "What did they do to you?" And my father, so again, all he yelled, "Do you know where your mother is?" And we said, "No." He says, "Don't look for her until we get home." That's all he told us. He was not allowed to talk to us, that's all. And then, the next day when we saw him, again, he already tried to, he recognized us already. He was in shock when he saw, not so much me as my sister. Yeah. She had beautiful dark hair. And he said, again, like in a lower voice, he said, "Promise you will eat everything and take care of each other. And if you find your mother, don't disturb her. We'll see her at home. We all are coming home." And you want to know something? I honestly believe. By the third day, my father, the men were already separated, so we did not see my father anymore, or my brothers. We anyway could not, had no contact with him, but we did see him because he was in the same Zeelager. Now, it turned out, as we were standing in this appel, we did not work in Auschwitz yet. So all day we were allowed to go because the bathroom facilities were in the first. We were in 18. The first one, which still stands in Birkenau, because you went back, was also like the same type of barrack.
Okay, we're going to end tape 3 here. We'll pick this up with tape number 4. We're beginning tape number 4, interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. It is September 28th, 1997. When we had left off, Mrs. Friedman, you mentioned you did not work
at Auschwitz,
and you were beginning to describe the appel and what you did do on a daily basis.
Well, it took about 2 to 3 hours. We were standing in line. After that, we got... I don't know what it was, but the first 2 days, I know everybody refused to drink it. Whatever they put in, it was like a coffee or a soup, whatever. We got that in the morning, and we got like a slice of, it looked like a piece of brick. It was supposed to be bread. But after 2 days, everybody drank it, and everybody ate it. That was our daily food. Now, as I mentioned to you before, there were no facilities other than the first block, first barrack, had, I would say it, the barracks were like half a city block, I would say, because we were like 501. So one of these barracks was the facilities. In the morning after appel, automatically they walked you there. And it had like a bench from here to Canarsie and all holes in it. And that's where we had to go to the bathroom. Now, what we learned when we went back to Auschwitz now, that the Germans in Machschemoy used even that for to use as fertilizer. That's why they let us go. They made us go once a day. But you really were allowed to go during the day also. You had to tell every block had a woman standing in front who was supposedly watching us. She was, the Kapo she was called, who was a Jewish woman. That Kapo, if you went to say, I have to go to the bathroom, we went. Now, my sister and I always managed to go by together because we were afraid to leave each other. My sister threatened to go to the wires, and I threatened to go to the wires. But then we both decided if I go, she will go, and if she goes, I will go. So we watched each other's movements all the time that we should survive. My father said we have to take care of each other, and that is the reason, the main reason that we survived, because I was very young. Now, when we used to go to these, to the bathroom, and the other, we were in the Zeelager. We once met my sisters, as I told you, she was engaged before the war. Her future mother-in-law was there with her two daughters in block 18. We were in block 18 and she was in block 22. And she, her somebody was the couple by her. And you know, like a Jewish mother, she wanted us to be with her. She felt she's older, she will be able to take care of us. Now, she, in the middle of the night, I don't know what she, maybe she still had a ring somewhere, because everything we owned was taken away. Some people did save a ring or earrings in their mouth. We didn't. Maybe she did, I don't know. She bore off the couple. In the middle of the night, they brought two girls from their block, from the number 22 to number 18, and they exchanged us. So she felt she would be able, which was very good to some, for some purposes, because it made us feel more comfortable. But it was terrible because we were torn away from all the people that we grew up with. Now, one day, they never realized, because by this time we did not have names anymore. We were only called by our numbers. So I guess the numbers didn't make any difference to them. They had the numbers. They never caught on that we were exchanged. And it worked against us to some extent because her mother-in-law was a little older, and she was from this appel. They picked every day who they thought will not be able to survive, is not, didn't like their face, thought they're too old. She was picked out from this very early in Auschwitz yet and taken away. So we remained anyway without an older person. But we had her two sister-in-laws. She had three sister-in-laws, as a matter of fact. One was a married lady that was married to her husband's brother. So the three, we, and two nieces of theirs. So the seven of us became a family. We took care of each other. If one was sick, the other one was, you know, counting for her. When they were going with the stick counting, if I was sick, they somehow, the two of them held me up, whatever. We stuck out, we looked out for each other, which happened very often in the lagers. Otherwise, a person alone could not survive. If somebody was weaker, we shared that little verstinkene soup. Anyway, so we were the seven of us. And one day, I don't know if this is interest of any, as we were standing in appel, in the other lager were French and Belgian girls that were there already for years. Now, one girl that my mother used to, my mother was a very generous and very, that's the way Jews lived in those days. She had, as I told you, we had a girl in the house that used to That was like our Aufzandlich, it was called, like a foster child, really. And that was her sister, and she remembered us. And they had it already better, because they were in the Scheisskommando, it was called. They were working in Auschwitz. So they would go every day when the transports came in, they were selecting the clothes. So as I said, they took off all our clothes, all our, they found in packets a little candy, a little bread, which they were not supposed to keep, but they did. So she threw us some goodies over the wires. Mm. And one day another girl, which was not my sister, she threw it to us. She would yell, Grünberger girls, and we ran, and she threw it far enough. And when somebody turned, we ran. But meanwhile, one kid ran for it and touched the wire and died right then and there. So we yelled back, never do it again. I don't need it. I want to rather die of starvation. So which goes to show we had very strong characters. Mm-hmm. All seven of us agreed that we do not want anything extra. Mm-hmm. So that's done. We were in Auschwitz for about, I'd say 2.5, I can't remember dates. But I would say about 2.5 months, maybe 10 weeks, something like that. Then came one day when they were counting us out, they picked 500. What had happened in Auschwitz is if somebody wanted to have 500 maids, they just came in and said, we want 500 slaves. So somebody came for 500 girls, and we were the block 22 they picked from, and we were lucky ones, we were picked in. Now they put us again in wagons, and they took us, I don't know how long it took, I cannot remember, but we got to a town called Fallersleben. When the train stopped, we saw it said Fallersleben. I know it was already, it had to be more it had to be more than 3 months, at least 3 months, because it was already snow. Mm. When we got to Fallersleben, we got off the train, and there was snow on the ground, which we never saw in Auschwitz. I don't know why. Maybe we were traveling long. I just remember getting off and looking at the town. But from there, we were walking like maybe half a day. And by now, our shoes were... We had no socks, no underwear. But anyway, we got there, and they took us into a building, which was a brick, big building. And we kept on saying it was cold. It wasn't heated, but it was not a barrack, a wooden barrack. So they gave everybody one blanket. We figured we did the right choice, which we did, it turned out. Anyway, we got also like bunk beds, like three layers, and two people slept on each little. It wasn't a bad little. So it was a tremendous improvement for us. First of all, we had a blanket. Second of all, we only were two bodies against each other. The next morning, we were taken into, we were working in a factory that made Oknos, it's called in Hungarian, landmines. And we were working chamber. You know when they do this, you put in, it comes on a chain.
Right.
The pin, comes down.
Pull it out and
no, whatever.
Oh, so
you do this and you do this.
Oh, an assembly line.
Assembly line.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So, of course, we managed the seven of us to stand next to each other. We were assigned, my sister's sister, no, she was pushing the machine, I think, that was making a hole and this one. Whatever, we were standing one after the other in this line, which was a godsend lifesaver, because if one couldn't work, the other one would make sure that it didn't go through without it, because that would have been that. Now, we were treated pretty humanly, which for a lager, we were allowed to take a shower once a week. They made us a shower room. And it was like like an assembly. You do today, these people. It was one room. It had 20 showers, and we were 500 girls. It had also 20 stalls, you know, like. So we had to work it out who went when, but once a week we could take a shower. They also had, it was called a revere, where if you didn't feel good, you went into that room, you never came out alive. The next day they send you back. So in our case, oh, and we worked shifts, 2 weeks, 12 hours during the day, and 2 weeks, 12 hours during the night. Now, I was at this time 15. And we did get every morning hot black coffee and a piece of this bread. Something wasn't that coffee. You will excuse my expression. We never menstruated, none of us. And we were like zombies. We did not even think really clearly. Like we never thought what happened to us or what is going to happen. We were only busy surviving that one day. However they did this to our minds, I don't know. The only way looking back, I think they must have put something in the food, what we were getting. Because we did get on Sundays, we got a soup that had like, maybe it was some kind of chigos, like snails or something had inside, or some kind of meat that we were not familiar with. Once a week we got a hot soup with something in it. But every morning we got hot coffee.
Did it bother you at that point, or did it mean anything to you?
What we ate?
What you ate, that it wasn't kosher?
No way. No way. Although, one of the seven of us was the oldest who was married at home. Every Friday night she made believe she's lighting candles, believe it or not. And she would all call us around her bunk and say the bracha of candle lighting. And she would take a piece of paper, wherever she found it, put it on her head, and say, shh, I'm lighting candles and Shabbos is starting. Even if we were at work, she would, now I'm sending lecht. And she would say the bracha aloud. So we tried to be Jewish, but no way, no. Nobody was concerned with kosher. No. I mean, we were concerned to survive. That I can honestly say. Now, into the middle of the winter, must have been around January already, maybe December, January. As I told you, even as a child, I had a problem ear, and I developed a middle ear infection. I had fever to up to 104, burning fever. They didn't know what to do with me, my group. Well, the SS was not supposed to know this. So they would hold on under, they would start begging. This lady, the one that was this, her name was also Suri. She would say, oh, you know, I am so cold. Would you just let me hold my blanket while you, in that Zelapel, we also had to stay in Zelapel. And they would let them stand, my sister and this lady would stand me between them. I could not stand up. Just so not to leave me in the revere, because then during the day they would take me away. And believe it or not, they did save me. I look back now. I was 15. I couldn't even talk from the fever. They took me with me, we walked to work, which was about, I think it was like 2 kilometers in the snow. And I got there and I stood up. They worked instead of me. Like that's why I said they put me and they were doing my whatever I was punching there. And they took me, this lasted a week. And then I said, I am not going, I refuse to go. And I was hysterical. I just said, I cannot do this no more. And everybody's gonna go down the drain. They're gonna catch you that you're doing this. So my sister went during the night, when the coffee came, when it was very hot, she snuck out from bed and tore off a piece of her blanket and stole some coffee and put it in that hot coffee and put it on my ear. It should open, that I should be able. And she was caught. Mind you, She was caught by the Jewish couple. She beat the hell out of her. But she stood up to it, and she kept on telling her, believe me, I'm not drinking it. I'm not stealing it for whatever. She beat her so that the German woman, we were with Wehrmacht, we did not have an SS, only during the work hours, not during the night. So the German Wehrmacht came out and said, what's going on? So my sister admitted that, yes, she's bringing me the hot compress. And she told her why, and she said, wait. She went into the Revere and brought out, it must have been two aspirin, gave it to me, made me drink that hot coffee, and like a miracle, in the morning I stood up and I went back to her. And I survived. It was meant for me to survive. After that, I was weak for a while, but as I said, always two of my cronies was, I was between them, and I didn't work much for a while. Then I made up for it. Luckily, we were after that night shift, and in the night shift, they did not watch as much as the day shift.
Now, so, you said this was a group of seven?
My family. You're
right.
We were there 506 girls.
But your group
was? We were seven cronies.
What were the names of the people in the group?
Well, the oldest was Suri Seidenfeld, who was married to my sister's fiancé's brother, who wasn't with us, but the second one was Miriam Seidenfeld, who is still my sister-in-law today. The third one was Yocheved Seidenfeld, her sister. And then my sister Mildred, myself. And then there was this older Suri had a niece who died there also, you see, who did not want to come with us, and she one day stayed in the Revere, that's how we knew. And she stayed just for the day they promised us. We came home, we never found her again. And she never was. So she was, Fagi her name was. I don't remember her second name. Gassenbauer, I think. I don't know. Fagi her name was. And then there was another niece who was here. Felice her name was, Seidenfeld. So we were the seven that we stuck out. We remained six of us under, to be liberated, only six. This Fagi one day stayed with high fever. She was my age. She was also one of the youngest ones. And she was more fragile. And she refused to, she did not have a sister like I had that said, if you stay here, I'm going to the wires. And we both perished. So we both survived and she didn't.
When you were at this camp, other than the Shabbos candles, which this woman
pretended
symbolically was lighting, for example, did you know when a holiday was coming up, or were there any other attempts at religious observances?
There was, I didn't even think, really. Although we felt Jewish, like she would always say that she knows the Suri, that she knows by heart how to daven, would we listen? We didn't really listen. We just went to sleep and went to work and waited for that hot coffee in the morning, whatever. No. We weren't even concerned with religion.
What
it was just coming and going, the days.
What was a typical conversation that you might have? What would you talk about if you had a moment to talk?
Well, you know, believe it or not, there were times when we sang in the quietness. We always planned what we were going to eat when we were liberated. And when we got this soup that had, it looked like worms, and especially for a Jewish person, maybe it was some kind of, I don't know what it was. And we said, for one thing, we will never put worms in the soup. And mostly we were concentrating on when we will go home, we will tell our parents that how good we were. We listened to the Verstinkene Germans and we were obeying and we were eating whatever they gave us. Mostly, we certainly did not have an intelligent conversation ever. We were not planning or what's going to happen. Very often now we look back. I said to my sister, you never even thought about your fiancé. She says, no, I was glad that I'm going to go home and have him. It never dawned on us that we will not go home and go back to normal life. I guess that's what this is all about, that we could not have survived knowing that this is going to end the way it did.
How long were you at this labor camp?
Well, we were at this labor camp. Again, I can't tell you exact dates, but it was still very big snow, and it had to be around end of March, I would say.
1945?
1945. We worked for a long time. We used to walk, I must also add to this, we used to walk to this factory and pass houses. And maybe that's what instilled in me the fact that they say now, but I didn't know, and these young kids would pick up the curtain, we would see that. We were walking, marching in the middle of the street in the snow, and they would live in this and then pick up the curtains and look and stick out their tongue. And later, when it wasn't so cold, they would just throw things at us. And we would smell the bread, and we would think to ourselves, we will never do this to human beings. So we weren't even thinking, because we should have thought that I will be liberated, I'll kill all of them. Never entered our mind. I always ask myself this question, why not? My only sin was being born a Jew and being born in the wrong place, in the wrong time. Why wasn't I ready to kill them? Never even dawned in my mind. It's very weird, though, how God makes your mind work. I don't know. I really don't understand that.
Is there anything else that stands out in your mind about your time?
No, just that we worked and we were good. And we were not really beaten unless misbehaved, which we tried not to. My sister was the only one. I mean, there were other girls that sometimes were beaten, but only for whatever reason. Either they went into the shower when it wasn't their time, or if they went to the bathroom when it wasn't their time. Now, you and I know human nature is such that sometimes those things would happen, and we were all women, and we did not come from the woods. Most of the times, if somebody went on my time to the bathroom, I would never snitch. We really never snitched, unless you were caught doing it. Because we made it in such a way that these three rows and this hour, you know, like, so if somebody was caught by the German, she was beaten, not by us, mostly by this couple. I don't know if I can add this sense, maybe not fair. This couple is here in the United States. To show you the characters we are, the German consulate called us up once, my sister and myself, to come up and see if we can identify her, because there must have been people complaining. I did not go, but my sister did go. They offered to pay us the car fare, whatever, because we were working girls. I don't remember the reason why I didn't go, but they said either one of us is enough. She went, and she saw her picture and did not want to identify her.
Why?
I think she was right. What good would it have come out from that? Maybe she did this to survive, and maybe she did not have the same character I have. I'm not God. It isn't up to me to judge. She survived. Fortunately or unfortunately, her son got married, and I see her occasionally, because one of her sons married a very distant relative of ours, daughter, and we were invited to the wedding, and she couldn't understand the other side, the girl's mother, why I don't want to go. I says, no way. I did not tell her the reason. And I believe I was right. I don't want to play God. I did not hit a German when I had a chance. It might have something. Can I stop? Maybe I should give credit to my parents for that. Jews are not fighters. She probably felt that this is how she's saving herself or her position. This was something that anybody would have wanted to. She did not go in the snow 2 miles to work. She stayed indoors while we were working 12 hours and walking 4 hours. Not her. So maybe this is what it was. So we both decided, my sister and I, we are not God. We are not here to judge. God will take care of her. This I believe. I believe in the next world. Let her get her punishment by somebody else. She is here. I have occasion to see her once in a while. I don't say hello and I don't say goodbye, and she does. Oh, don't you remember me? I says, I don't remember lager years. I really don't. And I walk away. And that's, I guess, that's my makeup. But she is here. She exists. And yes, in those working months, anybody that was beaten, mostly was beaten by her, was caught by her, and was beaten by her. And not very nicely either. Next question.
Where did you go after you left?
Well, we, from here, I think once or twice we heard bombs falling around, so we knew there's something going on. So I guess they must have bombed the factory also, because this was a big ammunition factory. We did see civilians working, whom we were not allowed to even look at. We had a separate, we had an entrance with them, but I guess we came earlier or later. We did see them, though, not between us. So I guess this was a very big factory, and it might have been bombed, because sometimes towards, it was still snow, so it had to be around March. Excuse me. We were lined up, and I remember we were allowed to take our blanket, so because we only had that one dress, and we started marching.
Okay, we're going to end tape 4 here, and we'll pick this up with tape number 5.
Okay.
We're beginning tape number 5, interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. It is September the 28th, 1997. Mrs. Friedman, when we left off, you were describing your departure from the labor camp that you were at. You mentioned that you heard bombs.
We did. We heard them even while walking. We walked, I don't know how long, for a long time, days and days. We did, not obviously, but a few times they stopped, like if they found a stable, and they would put us all in there for the night, watch us. So must have been quite a few days. Some of the girls, not too many, I wouldn't say, most of us did make the walk all the way, I guess. We had enough energy yet. And we made it till, it was towards end of March, because we made it till Salzwedel, it was called.
And where is that located?
In Germany. Mm-hmm. We are still in Germany. And we came there, it was like a, also some kind of like a ghetto type of thing. We did not have, we had like a military barrack already, and we put there, we were very weak. They gave us water already. We used to stop and drink the snow, which gave us survival time, because we did not get food on this trip at all.
During the march?
During the march, no. I don't remember getting food. I just remember when we got to this place that's called Salzwedel, we did get something to drink, hot. And then we got enough water to drink. We didn't have to drink the snow anymore. By now, the snow where we were in Salzburg, there was very little snow because it was people on top of people. Looking back, what probably happened is that we could not walk any further. Not because we couldn't survive, but because the, so to speak, enemies were coming nearer. This was already April 10, 12 when we got here, around April 10th. Unfortunately, here already we saw bodies laying around, nobody paid attention to it. We were not counted in the morning. They were just trying to pick up the bodies. We were not working anymore. But this lasted only like 3 or 4 days. We were becoming very weak. We were staying in this barrack, we were shivering, we went out, when we found snow, we were drinking. We did get something to drink once a day, if I remember correctly. And it must have been about the third day, when one girl walks in and she says, believe it or not, there are no SS around. Here we already were walking with SS. They were already like not gentle or anything, they were hitting if you opened your mouth. There's no SS outside, and nobody believed her, nobody moved. She says, I swear to you, I did not see an SS. So another girl, it was like this type, you know, of a big door type of thing. She we used to close it because we were very cold. So she opened it, she says, let's look out. So one girl looks out and looks, and nobody yelled to close the door. So little by little, one at a time, we started to go out, and we did not see no SS. And as we are going, everybody started to go, like, you know, an ave, as weak as we were. All of a sudden, we were liberated that day. Nobody believed that for hours we wouldn't move. And we were liberated by the 8th Infantry, I think it's
the
called.
8th Army?
8th Army. And they came very slowly. Who understood English?
These were Americans?
Americans. Okay. I guess there must have been one or two Jews between them. They started to say one or two Jewish words, and we kept on, oh, my God, oh, my God. We were liberated. They said, you're free to go wherever you want to. Now, whether you believe, oh, and as they opened the gates, like the next yard or something was like a dairy place. We started going over the gates into this dairy place, and whatever we found, we started drinking, and it was not milk, it was the thing that you make butter from. And everybody got sick the next day. So they started begging us, don't eat, we'll bring you food. We didn't understand what they were saying. And as they came in and they saw all these bodies, it turned out that we were only like 15 minutes from Bergen-Belsen. So they already saw what's going on. Their shock was that this was continuing. They figured Bergen-Belsen is finished. But we didn't get to Bergen-Belsen. We are just a few miles, we were from Bergen-Belsen, which of course we didn't know. So they kept on saying, please, no, don't eat. We did not understand them, and of course we did. Some girl came in with a sack of sugar, and we kept on grabbing, which was natural. So everybody got sick the next day. A lot of them did die the next day. Got terrible diarrhea. Again, all six of us survived, maybe because we were not such, we were very weak already. We did not run there. They brought us a little. We did grab whatever we could. And a few hours later, a Jewish chaplain came in. A few hours just. And he started talking to us in Yiddish, which all of us understood. And said, you can go in, we will open all the stores. Please don't take food in Yiddish. Try not to eat. You will have from now on whatever you need. Now, we did go in. We were all women. We did not kill or hit not one German. One of the guys said, you can kill them all. We did not touch a German. That goes to show you what a Jew is. We are not Germans. And they could not make us into animals, no matter how hard they tried. We went into stores. Some girls robbed the watch. Some, we did not go overboard. We all ran to look for a clothing store. Some of them got clothes, some of them didn't. Some of them were too weak to walk. I did not go into town at all. I was too weak. But my sister did. And this bigger Suri, that was my mentor, she went and she brought me, I remember like now, she couldn't find the dress, but she found a big kerchief because everybody was always worried about my ear. Mm. And she wrapped it around me and I said, I am in heaven, for sure. Well, that, and from then on, we asked to go to Bergen-Belsen where there are more Jews. But we were not taken there, but we did get food and we got like, they took us to another place, I don't know where it was till this day, and they took us by military, like these open
like a Jeep?
Trucks, like not the jeeps, the bigger things. Mm-hmm. They put us on gently already, and there was a doctor, an American, he examined everybody, they tried to calm us, they put us, must have been a school. We were there like 2-3 days, and whoever wasn't sick, the Red Cross came after about 3 days. I don't know if it was the Red Cross, or it must have been already a Jewish Gemeinde. And they started to take our names, and a lot of people, they couldn't talk yet. But anyway, we could talk already, and we gave them our names, and we kept on saying that my sister and I, that my father is with my three brothers, somewhere in a camp here. It turned out that Bergen-Belsen was liberated 2 days before us. So from there, some of them walked, which I said wasn't that far, walked over to our, where we were, and were looking, everybody was looking for either way, for family, for relatives. And one of the guys recognized us and said, listen, and in Bergen-Belsen were men also. We did not have men in our groups. So some of them, one man who knew my father and was together with them, said, your father and your two brothers are alive. And we kept on arguing with him. We have three brothers alive. He says, that I don't know. I just know I was till like 2 months ago with your father and with your two brothers, and they are fine. So we right away registered to go home. We're going home. One thing I knew, my father is going to look for us. Where is he going to look for us? We're going to try. We could register where we wanted to go. Now, we were taken from there to a lager. It was a DP camp sort of thing. We already got, everybody got their own bunk. And we were getting already normal food, and we ate it. We still ate trade food. We didn't care. Now, we were there maybe 2 weeks when a gentleman walked into this barrack, and he said, anybody from Czechoslovakia that wants to go home, I am here with a small boat that the Germans confiscated with me together, not right here, in... Right, so I have it written down. I don't remember exactly the town, but I have it written down. And we are going, and I'm going on the Alba. That's one of the biggest rivers in Germany. On the Alba back, I'm taking my ship back to Czechoslovakia. I can take 80 girls. That's how many passengers I'm willing to take. It shouldn't take more than 2 days. I'm taking you till Praha, which is the capital of Czechoslovakia. Of course, we ran. You almost got killed, but we were lucky. We got into this group of 80. They took us with trucks to, what was the name? Can I stop a second and look?
We'll go back important. To it on the okay. break.
They took us to this place with the buses, and we got on this boat. We did get some food because this trip was supposed to take not more than a day, or maybe a day and a half, he said. Fine. Luckily, my sister and I weren't even seasick, believe me. And as we were going, we came to a certain bridge which was bombed and the ship couldn't get through, and that was Russian territory. Now, so he was a gentleman, and he said in Czech, you don't have to worry, I am not leaving you here. I have to stay with the ship, but I am not, I'm responsible for you. So the Russians right away came and were with the, like the Nazis, I'm telling you. You have to get off, you're staying here. And he stood on his ship, he says, they are not, you have to shoot us all. We are not getting off. So finally he made with them a deal, we did get off. And they let him somehow get through to the Czech government, who sent for us trucks. Because the ship had to stay there for 3 days until they will clear a pathway, or for 3 weeks, whatever the case. Now, when we got into this, and they took us off, and we stayed there by the Russian, they had a camp there. And they weren't going to let us go. And one girl started to run, that she's going to survive this too, of course. Of course, the truck ran over her both legs. They let her stay there. They wouldn't let us touch her. And you know, after all this, she was like a sister. We were like sisters to each other. We had to let her stay there, die. Oh, blah, that was after the war by the Russians. Now, from there, somehow this man came with us, and he wasn't going to give them the ship. And about, we stayed there overnight, stayed, not even set. And the next day, there came cars for us, buses for us. Not buses, trucks, military trucks. They took us to a train station, and it took another, maybe a day. And the feeling when we passed the border and we saw the Czech flag, that was it. Even though it was Russia, but there was still a Czech flag hanging now. We're getting into Prague. And Prague was already a Jewish commando who had like a little pension where they put up whoever wanted to, whoever came back from the war. You knew, you went to this place, you got a hot soup, brambory zamachko, it's a favorite Czech potatoes with soup. And we all got warm soup the Red Cross was there, and they took all our names. Now, we right away registered. We want to go back to Irshava. We want to go to Irshava, back home to our parents. So, all right, they will try to work on this. It will take a few days. My mother had a cousin who was the chazan in the main Prague synagogue before the war. And he survived. And this was the fashion of those days, that everybody was coming to this particular place and put their name there. So whoever came next, you were reading the names. Oh, this one is alive. Oh, this one. My name is so and so. I come from here and here. So this man also put in, and then we also right away automatically put our names there, and he saw our names, so he was willing to take us out, but he was alone, and he had his place, though. He had an apartment. So we said, no, we're not staying in Prague. He was going to take care of us, which was very nice of him. His family didn't come back. So he said, no, we have to go home because my father and my brothers are coming home. The next day, my future brother-in-law, if you believe in miracles, he had gone home already because He ran away from when they bombed his transport because he was in the same lager as my father. He ran away and he went home to the Russians earlier. So when he comes from Bereksas, which is a town bigger than I come from. When he came home, he saw nobody is home. He turned right back, a man is not a girl. He went, you know, with buggies and with trains on top of trains. He came back to Prague to look for people, for his people. He came back and he saw us on the list. He knew already that one of my brothers died, was taken away. And he also knew that my father was shot because he was in that group and he had guts enough and ran away. And my brothers were liberated 3 days later after this happened. But they were very sick already by then, and they couldn't run. My brother-in-law did run home. So he knew that my father was shot, and he knew that my two brothers were very sick, and that they were in Theresienstadt. He left them there. He did not know anything else. Now, Theresienstadt was Slovakia, Sudetenland. And we were in Czechoslovakia. This is all borders. I explained to you before that I put in that I was born in Bratislava, so I can go to Sudetenland. But then my brother-in-law and my sister decided I cannot go. I was still too weak, and they are going by themselves, and I'm staying with this man in his apartment, which I did. I stayed there for 3 days, and they went to Theresienstadt. Again, there were no scheduled transportations. So they hiked and they got there. They came there, they found out. Theresienstadt was a lager that was supposed to be for the Red Cross to be able to, that's one of the concentrations camp which they claimed fame to, that they keep families there. So that was a good place to be. So we figured very good, if they are there, they are fine. Which turned out, no, they were not there. They were taken by train, I don't know which way. They said where we can follow my two brothers, because they were too weak and too sick. They both had typhoid fever. So my sister came back for me, and my brother-in-law wanted his two sisters, and we are following to Germany back. There's nothing to go home for. He said that right away. He said he went to our hometown. Nobody came home. Nobody's registered to go home there. You are not going to the Russians. We're going back to Germany and to the Americans. Well, we all made false statements that we were born there, and we skipped through the border. And when we skipped through the border, we registered that, where are we going? We're going to Palestine. So at that time started already, this was already in 1945, in the middle of the summer, towards the end of the summer almost. And they had already at that time the Aliyah Bet, the unlegale Aliyah, so we registered on that. And they took us from Praha yet. That's how we skipped through all the, and we're going to Germany. And while we're on this train, I don't know the dates, when they, if you remember the YouTube or whatever it was called, that they didn't let, they let it drown with all the people. So there was a halt to the Aliyah Bet. So they took us to Landsberg am Lech, which was a DP camp. We get to this DP camp with this train, and there were all Polish men, 3,000 Polish men there. And we were these young girls. We were, what, 6 girls. My brother-in-law was the big hero of ours. But anyway, we struck out very lucky because we decided this is it. My sister and my brother-in-law were going to go look for... on the way in this Aliyah Bet train, we met a whole group, like we were 7, with who, by the way, we are still very good friends till this day. They were also a group, a family of sisters and brothers and cousins. And all. They were 8. And there were also 6 girls. There were 9. 6 girls and 3 boys. One brother-in-law, 2 brothers. So we stuck together. And they gave us adjoining rooms, these two families. I mean, we were together, the boys and girls, and we were the most honest, the most decent people in the world. So this is how my sister, the Red Cross helped us, though, to find which hospital my two brothers were taken, and they insisted, they were crying for this, they took my sister there. Now, one of my brothers were, because Landsberg had already a hospital unit, so we wanted them back. So one of my brothers was brought, the other one was too weak to be transported. We were so thankful to God that we wanted to eat kosher already. So we were free to roam around. We went to the fields, we found a potato, we put together, we started cooking on this makeshift. We started to practically start back to that. So the chaplain of the 8th Army came to talk to us. He got to know us a little bit. He came once or twice. So the one thing he did for us, there was the UNRWA, I don't know, UNRWA, I don't know what division they were of the American Army. They gave my sister a jeep and two soldiers, and they went with this. One was, must be like here, looking back. First aid, you know, like a first aid something, a medic, some kind of a medic. They brought back my older brother to this hospital because we were begging and crying for this. So we felt, and then we learned the fate already of my father.
Now, what did happen to your father, briefly?
Well, take a deep breath. My younger brother, they were walking, they were not in wagons, but they probably were passing like a station that was being bombed. At this particular time, they were already walking from Theresienstadt. Must have been many days, because going back, we went back to this place, so I know it's a long distance, big distance. And when it was bombed, the SS were afraid more for their lives, so they just, it was near the woods, near a very tiny village near woods. Everybody had to go down from the highway into these woods, and they hid out there. Now, while they were bombing, I guess a lot of people, the shrapnel, whatever, the train was bombed completely. Some people were injured, some people couldn't walk anymore. So afterwards, they said, everybody get again, when everything quieted down, get in line. And my father was probably too slow to get in line, and as my brother was helping him, they shot him, and they shot through my brother's hand. So he always had this, till he died, you could see where he was shot through. Now my brother was 17 and a half years old. And my older brother already was in the beginning, he saw it, but he was not allowed to turn back. So when they saw, they shot 256 people out of this group. I don't know how many were the original group. When they decided that this is already end of the war, I mean, this is only hearsay by me. They probably figured, let me do something with these bodies. It was near a town. So they announced that whoever is capable of digging is staying behind. So my brother right away volunteered, the younger one. The older one didn't even hear this, and he was anyway too weak to do it. So my younger brother volunteered between the rest of the boys. They started digging, and he said to the Jewish guys that were next to him, there were a few non-Jews already also in this transport. I think what happened, they came off this train probably, because their group was originally only Jews. So he said to the Jewish boys, listen, this is my father. He's grabbed off somebody very heavy rubber boots, and he put it on my father's feet. And he said, the war is almost over. You can see that already. I am coming back for him, so I want to bury him. And the boys naturally agreed. So they had this mass grave. He put my father first, and he said, He said to the German, listen, this, you have to, would you allow me? You know how tracks are being made in Europe. It's always like high up. So they have little stones put there. Says, you know, in our religion, that's the only thing we do for a dead person. We put stones on the grave. Can I go take a few stones and put on this grave? He didn't say, I'm my father. So they allowed him. So he went, you know, how sometimes you count feet. Like this, he started walking slowly. He counted exactly how far this spot is from the tracks. And he looked up and he memorized the name of the little station. He came back, he put my father first. And they made this mass grave. Unfortunately, this part of the of Germany became East Germany, and he never could go back as planned. So we, of course, couldn't take him out. What then happened, my older brother, I'm getting ahead of myself, while in America already, many years later, they always wanted to take my father out and take to Israel. Being it was East Germany, there was no way. We wrote to the president. We did whatever you want to do. Nobody gave us permission. We asked Khrushchev permission. We never got permission to go. My younger brother, who was a big, you know, Yatovidan, he went to Hungary, which he got a visa for. But this was already early 70s. And he hired a cab driver, and he took him over the border, and he found the place. And when he found the place, he came there, and he saw, I will show you pictures later, that this was made into a monument, a national monument, this spot. He counted down the, and it, my father is buried right next to the, gates. Not the gate, the, you know, when you, I can't think of the word. And he came back, and my brother, he said to my older brother, as soon as we can, we're all going there, which we did. Now let's continue with the war.
Okay, we're going to end tape 5 here, and we'll pick this up with tape 6. We're beginning tape number 6, interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. It is September the 28th, 1997. Mrs. Friedman, when we left off, you had described the circumstances surrounding your father's burial and your family's attempts to correct that situation. At this point, we can resume with what happened to you. You had just found out what happened to your father and your brother, and you were on your way to Palestine, but you were diverted.
Yes.
How did you end up in the United States?
Well, we were in Landsberg, which was a DP camp. And this, as I said, this Rabbi Rosenberg realized we were only out of these 3,000 people. We were like 7, 8, maybe 10 that wanted kosher. And he also ate kosher, so he told us if we will take care of the house and cook, and he's going to bring us provisions, which worked out fine. He got us out of the DP camp into a private house. we were by now already 21 that wanted to eat kosher, and my sister and my sister and the older ones. I worked in the hospital, in the DP hospital, and my sister and the older girls were keeping house for this Rabbi Rosenberg, who was from Yonkers, an unbelievably gentle man. He came to marry me off. Yes, we became, he became like our angel, whatever you want to call it. And we had it, and to Israel we couldn't go. Now by now my two brothers were in the hospital for a long time, but they were getting better. And that's the reason that I worked with one of my best friends. I worked in the hospital for with the military. These were all Americans, but I had access to a little bit more goodies, and we built them up and they came out. So now we had to think what to do. Now, we decided not to go to Palestine. We were, my brother-in-law, he wanted to get married. And Rabbi Rosenberg wanted them to get married since they were engaged before the war, and we had nobody else to wait for. There was nobody in our Jewish tradition that has to be a couple to, you know, to take you. There was in this all 3,400 people, there were no married couples yet. So lo and behold, came a couple that was hiding out on Aryan papers with a four-year-old child. We got to know them, and they were my sister's interferers. So Rabbi Rosenberg was the official rabbi, and she got married in January 20-something, in 1946. So Rabbi Rosenberg arranged that they had a room for themselves. The rest of us, we slept, even though we were after the war, but we slept 11 of us in one room. On one side, we had a curtain hung. On one side, all the men slept. On the other side, all the women slept. And we were very honorable and very good kids. We didn't chatter with each other. It was fine. We had already normal, more or less normal food, war food. We certainly didn't have sugar or meat or whatever, but we had enough to eat, be it potatoes, we were fine as far as food goes. Already we started, in the camps, they started to give us all sorts of courses. We registered to come to America, which was a long wait. Out of the blue came Mrs. Roosevelt, not she herself, but somebody sent out by her that she is bringing 500 young underage people she's sponsoring, bringing in, and I was one of them. There weren't that many young, my age people. And I didn't want to go without any of my siblings. I had two brothers, you know. That was, they used to point at me with a finger. Look at that lucky girl. She has an older sister and two older brothers. That was the biggest thing. So I said, I'm not going by myself. I'm all in. My oldest brother, who was very protective of me, said, I guess you're right, you're afraid, but if you're going, we will have a foot in the, this will give a more of a chance to us. Now, then she said, being there were none, in this particular surroundings, there were no 500 underage. She let, if you had a sibling under 19 or under 18, the sibling could come along. Now, to put it on the lighter side, my brother, who is 3 years older than me, and there was another brother between us who is not here anymore, had to change again. We went a new birth thing. We did not have original because our town is Russia. You couldn't get papers. He made a new paper that he was born June 9th. He was afraid, June 14th. He was afraid he won't remember the date. So I was born March 6th, and he was born the same year, June 14th, and nobody ever caught up that it was a mistake somehow. So the two of us were taken to a place called Prien am See. It was a very beautiful, it used to be a German military, like a vacation spot. It was on a See in German is a lake. It was on a lake, a beautiful house. And we were there, 500 younger people from all over. But my brother and I were there. Now, we were there, they started to teach us a little English, and again, the problem came. We were eating kosher, my brother and I. It was far from Landsberg, so my sister couldn't send us food, really. And we registered that we are kosher, and altogether we were 7 of us kosher. So believe it or not, the social worker, the American, decided that we are outcasts. We don't know. We will never be able to, you know, get into the stream of life. We will be different. Anyway, came along Rabbi Rosenberg, saved us again, and explained that whatever, we were allowed to stay with them. We were there till December of, till November, end of November of 45 in this place. And then we were taken to come to America. We came to Bremerhaven. We were by train, they took us there. Again, I don't remember the days or whatever. But we are ready, my sister. You couldn't get material yet, and you will see on the picture. We took the blankets that we had from Germany. We washed it. We took it apart, and we made yarn out of it. And we all already had the Polish guys made us needles, knitting needles. We made ourselves sweaters, and we were already dressed. We felt we were normal. We came. The name of the ship was something, Isle, Ernie Pyle. Mm-hmm. It was a military ship. We were put on there, all 500 of us. It was pretty hard, but we didn't complain. And it took a while. I don't remember how many days we were here, how many days here, but we were on this ship already. And we were coming here. Almost everybody was sick, believe it or not. My brother and I were not. We were not sick. They gave us bananas, but luckily they were smart enough. Everything, we got already American food. Mm-hmm. The only thing we were ecstatic with, which we were familiar with, was peanuts. And we were eating peanuts from morning till night. And they were giving it to us. But anyway, we each got 4 quarters. Soda was a nickel, I believe. And they showed us how to use the machine. We were afraid to use it. Whatever. We were being oriented towards the life in America.
And
we were on this boat. The very stormy weather, whatever. We got here the very end of December. I don't remember exactly.
1946?
1945? No. The very beginning of 46, excuse mm-hmm. me. Yeah. 46, January 3rd, the very end, we were the first boat that landed here with refugees. There were boats or planes coming, like whoever had here family and was brought on a one-on-one basis. Right. But as far as boats, we were the first ones to land here. And of course, there was a big hullabaloo about us. Do you want me to continue?
Well,
don't ask me anything.
At this point, how did you find adjusting to life in America?
Very hard. Number one, I was 16. I had nobody. I had my brother that was older. Being brought up the way I was brought up, I knew that he will have to be a wage earner. He will have to get married. I was not brought up that girls are the pronosigaver, so to speak. So I worried for him. And I knew we will have to adjust to this on our own. So this, we were picked up at the boat and taken to the Bronx, to a school, for orientation, and the Red Cross, not the Red Cross came, social workers came. Again, we had the same number one problem. We didn't want to eat the food, and they thought we will never be Americanized, whatever. For what reason at that time, excuse me, the Kansas Kimmel. At that time, there, for somehow they didn't know that religious Jews exist, whatever. Those were the days that they probably were not aware of it. And when we got to this children's home, we were supposed to, we told them who was gonna, most people had families here or somebody here, and they right away came to claim them. They asked us, I had a cousin who lived in Highland Park, New Jersey, who was my first cousin, my father's sister's son. He was a wealthy man, and I gave his name. He came the next day, and he was willing to take me because he had an only daughter. What am I gonna do with him? I said, no way are we being separated. And then he told me that he has a clothing store and I will be able to work in the clothing store and take care of his girl, which was fine with me, but not on Shabbos. I told him right away, you know. He says, oh, but this is America. This cannot, you cannot do here. So I said, I'm not leaving here. Here I have what to eat. I will. Before I left Germany, my brother gave me the name of a rabbi in Williamsburg who was called at the time the Tzela Rav, who used to be Rav in the town where I came from. And my father was the one that was his sponsor, so to speak. He says, you call that rabbi if you are in trouble. He will help you. He knows who you are. And we gave this name. And they couldn't understand why we don't want to go with these people. We said, we started to explain, and somehow nobody was ever, these social workers were never exposed to religious people. And they can, then my brother started to say already, maybe this is the way we will have to live. I says, we have to try harder. No way. Because a lot of children did give up. They became religious after, but they were not, they could not face the unknown anymore. But this rabbi's wife, who also, they were childless, came the next afternoon by train from Williamsburg to the Bronx. I don't remember the exact address where I stayed. I know it was a school. And with tears in her eyes, she said, you can be here religious, you will be religious, I will make sure that you will be sponsored by a religious family. And right now, she says, I am bringing you in, but you don't have to live on peanuts and oranges. I'll bring you food. And there is a few blocks from here, very religious families that will bring you food. And lo and behold, that's the way it was. Mm-hmm. And that was the first time after I left home that I saw again Orthodox people. These people came, the woman had, I don't remember exactly, a lot of children, maybe 14, or there were two brothers living, their name was Rosenberg. They lived not far from the school that I was at with my brother, and they came, and Friday morning, this little old lady with her swollen legs came and said, you are coming to me for Shabbos, and you will see. She signed us out, all seven of us. And we walked into this house, and I come from an Orthodox background, but not as Hasidic as these people were. This was almost unbelievable to us that this exists in today's day. And from day on, that day on, we did have to be in this Kinderheim, in this children's home, for a little while. I don't remember exactly this, until this Rebbetzin, this Tzelem rabbi's wife, who was my mother's girlfriend, found us a very nice family in Williamsburg that came and signed us out. She looked at us and she said, you don't have to worry. But I said to this rabbi's wife, you don't have to worry about me. I'm young, but I'm determined. I'm going to go work no matter what, mm-hmm. and I'll support my brother myself. But no, for a few weeks, this organization paid for us by this lady.
Right.
She was Mrs. Gluck, also a very sweet, very honest. She gave us a room. She signed us out. She, like in other words, she was not really a, she was like our sponsor, really.
Mm-hmm.
She guaranteed that we won't become a burden to the state. But for a while, I went to night school right away. I registered, because I had to go to school yet. So I went to night school, My brother joined, there was already a yeshiva. My brother joined the Salem yeshiva right away. So he stayed there and he ate there. Only for the Sabbath he came to stay with me. And that's how I settled in America. I was 17 years old at the time.
Now, how old were you when you got married?
I was almost 20, 19 and something.
Mm-hmm. And your husband's name?
My husband's name is Morris. Now, I should also add, there were a lot of people, we were very new. People didn't know yet about refugees. And day after day, they would come and look at us and tell us how to touch a switch, to put on the light. They couldn't imagine that we are normal, which was very painful for us. We came from homes. Yes, we were very down, but we certainly were very human. And some people were the most helpful to us in how I started to work, how I got to work. It is unbelievable how some people are out of their way. Of course, some people just came to look at us as a, oh my God, these people are alive. They look like humans. You know, they have ears and eyes and whatnot. Other than that, we found, maybe it was just me personally, I came across a wonderful family that took me in for Pesach with my brother that weren't rich. And this man took the Jewish paper and took me every day to Manhattan and didn't go out of the train, made me a map how I should go where he saw a sign that they are looking. I said I know how to sew. And when I went every day to San Berzel because, of course, I did not know how to sew. And whenever I said, yes, I lied about my age. But nevertheless, I finally came to a place where I started to work, and the forelady asked the woman that sat next to me, does this girl know what she's doing in Hungarian? And I know Hungarian. And I started to cry silently, and I says to this lady next to me, listen, I understand what you are saying, and I'm going to tell you the truth. I don't know how to sew. But I'm a very good learner, and I'm very young. I told her I just came, whatever, and I must have what to eat. Well, this woman is not alive anymore. She right away took her garment and put it in my lap. So the foreman will come. They will think that I did it, and I did it fast, and I did it good. But I got this job. For a whole week, she worked for me. And I did learn, and I did become pretty good, and made my own, and made very good money, and was able to support my brother in school. My brother went to yeshiva for a while. I was able to save $300 in those days to send to Germany to get my older sister, who already by now had a baby. And they all came here. After a year later, my oldest brother came. This woman, I was a very religious girl. This woman was a Jew, and her husband was non-Jew. They were willing to adopt me and my brother, which of course we wouldn't be. But they treated us as their children. They were the most wonderful. And after I already was married, there was no holiday and no occasion that I did not have them with me, because they were to me my second set of parents.
And their names?
Their name is Viola Vake and Leslie Vake. My father was a very Orthodox religious person, and he would always say, how can you have them by a holiday? He was not a Jew. I says, he never walks into my house without a yarmulke. Whenever we go there, my husband, who afterwards, when we got married, we used to go, my daughter should still remember them. I don't know if my son would remember, because they did die. They were older than we are. And they bought special dishes and everything special. When we came, they never violated my religious beliefs. They respected me for what I was. They loved us for what we were. They were the most wonderful people. There were people like this also.
We had mentioned Your husband, how many children do you have?
Two. I have a daughter named Myrna, who was born. I got married in February 20. I met my husband here, and we got married February 20th, 1949. My daughter was born December 23rd, 1949. Mm-hmm. We had another child 5 years later, 4.5 years later. My son was born in 54, in January 31st.
And his name?
His name is Elliot. Mm-hmm. My daughter is named for my mother-in-law. My son is named for my father. The reason she was named for my mother-in-law is because in my husband's family there were no children yet. He was the oldest of the remaining family. And my mother already had a name, so this was... And luckily afterwards I had my boys, so my father finally had the name, which right. was a big accomplishment. It gave me a lot of satisfaction.
You are now blessed with great-grandchildren.
Yes. My daughter blessed us with 4 children. One is Miriam, who is 25 by now. My grandson is Tzvi, who is 22. He's going to be 23. Then I have a granddaughter, 21, I guess. So she was. And then she also has a daughter of 15, Faggy. The second daughter is Mindy, named for my mother already. My son has 4 children. His oldest, he married a girl. Her name is Adele Friedman, a very sweet girl from L.A., which worked out fine because, as I told you, we are very Orthodox, and she happens to come from the same background. I was very good friends with her mother before, so that was fine with us. I consider myself very lucky for all these happenings, that my children are going in the same ways we wanted them to. Mm-hmm. They have 4 children. The oldest is Chaya, who is named for both our grandmothers, mine and my husband's. The second one is Jonathan, who is named for my daughter-in-law's father. And then they have a little girl of, how old is Chevy? 12. My grandson is 17. My granddaughter is 18. A girl of 12, who is Chevy, and then they have a little girl of 9, Mary, who is named for my mother-in-law again.
As a final question to you, what message would you want to pass on to your great-grandchildren and to future generations?
Oh, I also have 3 great-grandchildren. Mm-hmm. Let me not forget to put that in. The oldest one is 3. Her name is Rachelea. The second one is Bina Huva, who is not even a year. And I have a 5-month-old great-grandson who is named for my grandfather. You know, by us Jews, it's very important to have a name. And he died just before the war, so for the last 60 years, he never had a name. And this is the first name. We were very fortunate.
Mm-hmm. So what would you want to tell them if they're watching this tape years from now? What message would you want to pass along?
I don't know. I really don't know what I want to tell them. I'm sorry that they have to cry over this, as I'm sure they will. Maybe what I would like, what I must add to this. As I told you, we took my children home, which was a tremendous accomplishment for us. We wanted very much to show them. I cannot question God why all this happened. I don't know. But I wanted to show them the fact that they are what they are today did not come from stone. Excuse me. They come from a very firm, very distinguished, very important background. Maybe more so than I want to tell them what I went through is that they come from. I think I accomplished that by taking them back home, by introducing them a little bit to the lifestyles that we had. Because somewhere along the line, in the United States, when we came, not anymore today, because we proved ourselves, there's so many, I don't know, do I have a right to say all this? You don't want to hear this.
You have a couple minutes.
There are so many nationalities that come. I would tell you that 95% of our people that came from these sort of backgrounds, that my husband and I came, did not go on welfare, did not go on no lines, did not kill anybody, did not rob stores. We all brought up families that are a credit to communities. It had to come from somewhere. And this is what I wanted to show my grandchildren. They should always know and be proud of their heritage. Because Jews are not killers. I have mentioned that before. After all they had done to us, I could not even today hurt a fly. But I could fight for my rights, which I did, and which I feel very thankful to God and very grateful that I did accomplish this. That's the message I'd like to leave them. And I hope it will have an effect.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Finished.
Yes. We're beginning tape number 7, interview with Mrs. Sarah Friedman. It is September the 28th, 1997.
Well, this picture is my grandfather, my uncle, and my father. The middle one is my grandfather, Ham Shlomo Gromberger. On the right side is my father, whose name is Elias Gromberger. On the other side is his brother, who is my uncle. His name is Shmuel Gronberger, who lived in a different country at this time. He came to visit his father, and my grandfather never wanted to take pictures. So this is the yard of his house. And the background is my grandfather's house. And they told him they're going to Daven together, Mincha. So he said, okay. And they snapped the shot, and that's the only picture that he had. The reason that I have this picture, I never went back home, and I did not find pictures from home, is that my father had a brother here who my grandfather never acknowledged, really. And he wanted to send him this picture.
And do you know roughly when this picture was taken?
This picture must have been taken. My grandfather died 60 years ago, which was in whatever. So this must have been around 37, 36. This is also a picture which is my two brothers. On the top, the older one is my brother Irving Gromberger, who died 3 years ago. And he was on this picture. This was taken in 1943. And the one underneath is my brother Moshe, who was killed in January in Auschwitz, as I said before. And on top is a little boy from Budapest who came. It was already Jews couldn't go to, you know, to like bad places or vacation spots. So my mother, this brother of my mother, she was sick at one time and was in pest and got to know this family and said, you know, there is, Jews are not allowed to go no place, but I have a big home in the country setting. You can send your little boy to me for the summer, which they did. So this little boy came with his sister. Lucky for me, that's how come I have this picture. His sister remained alive. They were never killed and never went to DP camps. So she had a few of these shots that I have another one I will show you from, which you will see later, because we never get anything from home. But this is what this picture is. This is the backyard in my house. On my left, on the top, in the top row, is my brother Ari. This picture is my only relative of my mother's that was available to us, because she lived in the next town to us, which was called Capania, and she was my mother's aunt, my grandmother's sister. So, of course, we were going back and forth there quite often. So, on the right is my brother Aaron, and then is my cousin Gabi, her name is. She's my age. The other one is Fritzi. She is a Mrs. Robinson, lives in the United States. And my cousin from my father's side, another Monsi Grumberger. And then there is Joines, who is from the other side. Next to him is my sister Monsi. Next to him is the son Pinchas and Shloimi. Now, going on the lower left is, I can't make the face who the first one in the right row is. The next one is my aunt, Mima Sima, and her daughter, Dvora. They had another little boy, so it must be that little boy. I don't know for sure.
And roughly this when?
This was done in 1943, or 40, end of 42. This was on an outing. We went there. We were going there very often. This is done in 1943 in my home's backyard, more or less, a little further down. And on the left side, the little boy is again the same one that came to vacation with us. And laying down on the other side is my brother Moshe, who was killed, going above him, on top of him, is my sister, Monsi. And very interesting, that girl, you see, this was already end of 43. She was the one that used to work for my father in the office. And she still kept coming to us. So she did not hate us, really. She loved her job, loved my father. Next to her, from right to left, is the little boy's sister, whose name is Blanca Klein. His name is Zindi Klein, and she is also from Budapest, was by us for that summer. And then I myself, my name is Serif, at the time, Grumberger. I am 43, I'm 13 years old there. This is my father, whose name is Elias Grumberger again. This is about sometimes an end of April, because I was liberated in April and he was still in camp. But this is about 2-3 weeks before he was killed. And I got this picture from the archives of the Red Cross with the history of what happened to him and my brother, which they do not have a picture of. You can see his striped uniform. You can also see the difference, how he looked before and what he looked at this stage. But I guess here, this was just before they started marching, because this was in Theresienstadt found in the 1945, taken, before they started the marching. This is 1945 in Landsberg am Lech already. This is already after the war when we had, yes, 1945. We had already what to eat. And this is a lady that was very good to me, that started, she knew how to sew, started to teach me how to sew so I can exist in the world where I'm going to, and made me these clothes. And almost, since I was the youngest in that group, I was everybody's pet. So I had already clothes and... So this, her name is Chaya Sura Weinstock. Unfortunately, he is not alive anymore. But I all my life I thanked her for how good she was, although she was my mentor after the war, not during the war. I did not know her during. This is already after the war. This is already in America when I got engaged. This is my future husband. We kept company, and his name is on my left. His name is Morris Friedman. And this is after we got engaged in 1948, end of 1948. He also came from Munkacs, from the other side, from all these camps and whatnot. And he had a father here, so he was luckier than I was. And we got married 6 months after this. This is the first official document that I ever had. This, we had to register that we want to go home or whatever, which we did. At the time, I did not want to go home. I wanted to go back to Czechoslovakia, to Germany, which I had to pass Sudeten, and it was a border. So, of course, I lied, and I said I was born in Bratislava, which was on the other side of the border. Which I really was born in Irshava, but this is 1945, the beginning, as soon as we got to Prague. This was done already in Prague.
And this was issued by who?
This was issued really by the Germans, that they said, yes, okay, this girl was here, whatever. The Red Cross was the one that, with this we came here. This was my dad. In other words, when I came here on my citizenship, and I didn't have enough brains to change it, so... But now I did. But on my citizenship paper, it still says that I was born there. This is really my father's signature. I'd like to just add to this. When we came to the United States and we started asking, I knew I have no pictures and nothing from home. No identification with my past. And I knew that in Israel there were people that knew my parents. And we asked if anybody has pictures of us. So this lady lived in Israel. And she sent us my father's signature that he had loaned her money. And when she had paid back, he had given her receipt sort of things. So he said, this way you will know that you don't come from the street. Which... Later on, you see, this is from 1940, which later on we found all these few odds and ends pictures, but when we came here with my brother, we had nothing to identify us with the past. This was the first thing that we could show. Yes, we had a father, you know. Everything else came after this. So that's all this document says, those few lines. That she thanks my father and she paid him back, or he paid her, whatever. I don't even know that. But that this was Grünberger, and that was his firma, you know. Well, this is, as I told you before, where my father was killed, they made this monument. And this is what is standing there. Unfortunately, even though 256 people are buried here. My father is the first one, so we know exactly which spot he's laying in. But on this stone, it says, which is quite a distance from my father, you see, because the gate, my father is next to the gate on the right side. And on the stone, on this document, it says in German that here lie all the Häftlingen. A Häftlingen are people that are just war criminals, really, not Jews, of French and all other descents, not mentioning that there are at least 210 of them were Jews, and they died for our fatherland, for unser fatherland, which means that because they were in Germany, in other words, they were on our side, which is full of baloney. I did try, and we are still trying, making every effort, which so far was fruitless. We would love to put up a Jewish monument there. We are going back. We were there twice already, my brother three times. Unfortunately, both my brothers died, But before he died, he still told me that that's the one thing he wants to accomplish, to put a Jewish something there and go with all our, with a minion out. We'll try. So far, we did not accomplish it yet. This is the house where I was born in, where I grew up in. It stands exactly the way we left it, except in the back, in the inside, they did a little changes, quite a bit of changes, though. We lived there alone. It was a big house. Two families lived there now, which were very nice. When we came, they let us go in, and they showed us and let us show around. As a matter of fact, the second time when we went, the first time they were skeptical, they were afraid we have a right to take it back, which what for? But the second time when we went, she made me promise never to go to a hotel or any place. After all, this house belongs to you. My children are the witness to that. You can come back anytime you want and sleep over in this house. So they were decent, but if I doubt whether I want to go back ever, even to claim it. As long as my children know where it is, so I don't feel that it's completely abandoned. I hope they will remember. I think they were impressed because it has a tremendous, tremendous backyard and a private way down to the river, which was our bathing place. We used to swim there all summer, and I showed them all that. So this is the way it looked, and only that this is just the front. It goes deep inside. It's an L-shaped house. This is my daughter's wedding, who is my firstborn and the apple of my husband's in my eye. This is 1970. This was done in Bradley Beach. And it was an unbelievable feeling that I lived to see a child of mine get married. We got a wonderful son-in-law. His name is Shmuel Liefer. By now, of course, they have already grandchildren. But this was one of the highlights of her life. This is the second greatest day of our lives. This is my son's wedding. My second child, Elliot Friedman, and his wife, as you can see, the bride and groom. In the middle, they have our first granddaughter, who is Miriam Liefen, and my daughter-in-law is Adele Pearl. And next, of course, is her mother, and the rest is all my immediate family. My sister, my two brothers, brother-in-laws, nieces, nephews. I don't think I have to identify everybody. When you will see it, by now you should know everybody, whoever will look at it. These are all my nieces and nephews. He got married in 1978 in Terrasander Park in Queens, New York. The girl is from LA, and we love them all very much. They also gave us by now four grandchildren. Okay. This is one very big milestone in my life, my first granddaughter getting married. And as you see on this picture, which was September 27th, 25th, and 93. She also has already two children, that great-grandchildren that she gave us, but on this picture is from left to right, my husband, myself, our grandson, Tzvi, our daughter, Myrna, Miriam, and her husband now, Cy Stern, my son-in-law, Shmuel Liefer, my daughter-in-law, Adele Friedman, Ellie Friedman, my son, Jonathan Friedman, my grandson. From left to right is Chayela Friedman, my granddaughter. Mindy Liefer, my granddaughter. Fagi Liefer. And then Miri Friedman and Sherry Friedman. These are my grandchildren. By now, I have another granddaughter married, and three great-grandchildren. And this is it. Hopefully, we only will be around to see from now on Nachas. One thing I wanted to add to this whole thing, I had asked my children, would they have done the same thing I did when bringing them up and not exposing them to all that? I don't remember if they ever gave me an answer, but my daughter said she anyway felt like a Holocaust survivor. She felt different, and that was somehow that I didn't think. I really wanted to accomplish for them to be very normal and very not know of what we went through till now. Now they are big enough to understand it. Thank you very much for giving your time to this. And what else can I add to that? The crew is just unbelievably wonderful. You helped me a lot. And I hope that it will never, ever happen again. And let's hope, I have heard somebody say something very good, very decent about this whole thing. I don't mind that I went through all this. It was not of my doing. Unfortunately, Israel was built on these ashes and on this, our bloods. Let's hope that we can keep it and there will be peace forever there. We deserve it finally, because our only sin was being Jewish. Good night.
Thank you.
I thank you, really thank you. You were wonderful. You put me very much at ease. Was it very hard for you to listen?
Mrs. Friedman, would you like to introduce your daughter to us, please?
Yes, this is my one and only daughter. Myrna Friedman, Nee Friedman, Myrna Liefer. She is, as I said before, married with four children, but she volunteered to come. She figured she's my moral support, which by now I don't need.
Yeah, well, I want to be here.
Yeah, she wanted to be here. She's part of the reason, her and my son, that I did this, because they did want to show it to their children.
Would you like to add anything at this time?
I did encourage my mother to do it for my parents. Hope my father will do it soon for a few reasons. Of course, we want the children to know. We did not hear a lot of these stories. We heard stories growing up about home on holidays and, you know, family times. We did hear stories about home, and that was one of the reasons that we were very anxious to go back with my parents, because that's part we knew about. We didn't hear anything about growing up, we didn't hear anything about the war itself. And, you know, we knew about all the family members that we had lost. We heard a lot of stories about that. And I wanted to have as many of the stories, as much of the facts as possible on record, so that we would have them for ourselves as well as for history. Also, I had been to the Holocaust Museum in Washington and a couple of other more recent history Holocaust memorials, and I just felt that the emphasis was, I don't know if it's really the emphasis, but there was no representation of the religious, the people that survived and maintained their values and their religious values from home. And I really thought that theirs should not be the only voice. It seemed, you know, I saw quotes from people who thought that, you know, God was dead and they had lost their faith, and I really felt that it was so important that my parents and their, you know, people that are like them should be represented, and, you know, the world should know that a lot of people did not lose their faith and did not lose what their parents had taught them and kept it going, here in America and, you know, for a lot of future generations. My mother's, I think maybe it's even pretty unique. My mother's father, my grandfather, has the four children that remained had 10 children among them. So we had 10 grandchildren, of which we now have, I counted before, but I forgot, in the 60s, of great-grandchildren. That's my generation. No, my children, I'm sorry. The 10 grandchildren, it doesn't matter. My children's generation, there are 60-something, and now, thank God, there's another generation, all of which are following in the path. Not one has gone off away from his religion. And I don't think too many families can say that. And I think it's really important that people know that this was important to them. So they just brought us up, that that's what's the most important, the family. Keeping to the old traditions and the old, you know, the values that their parents taught them and that they taught us and that we hope to pass down to our children. My childhood experiences really were, I didn't know anything else. All my cousins, all my friends, all my people that I went to school with were like me. So I didn't think that it was unusual. I mean, I knew that it was unusual not to have grandparents because I did have one grandfather. My father's father survived, and I hope he'll tell the story of that. And that was very unusual. My grandfather was the grandfather of everybody because nobody had grandparents. All my cousins from my mother's side, who he was not their grandfather, they all called him Zaidi. And he acted like, to, you know, all my friends, when we used to go over every Shabbos, we would go visit him, and he was just everyone's grandfather because he was one of the few left. My husband, his parents were brought up in America, both his parents, and, you know, religious and the same, you know, level of religious observance, but obviously, you know, a little with different kind of flavor, I guess you'd say, from America. And in recent years, I came across the fact, which just startled me so. I was at a family affair with sitting at a table with his cousins, and one of his cousins said something to me about how when she grew up, she did not know any children of survivors. And I started thinking, when I grew up, I didn't know any not children, not, I mean, that was my circle, and I didn't know any different. You know, now when I, maybe when I met other people and I look back and I think, you know, what it was like to be so conscious of the fact that we didn't have family. We had lost a lot of our family. I wouldn't say we didn't have family because we were a very close family. And I think really that's the main thing that came out of it, is that the importance of family was so emphasized. And all of us are very close, you know, my cousins. And we make a very strong effort to maintain that because it's very important. It's important to our parents. It's important to us. And we hope it'll be important to our children.
All right. Thank you both very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
Thank you again for the opportunity that I didn't think I can do it. I did it. I'm proud of myself.
I knew I couldn't do it without crying, so what can I say?
And as I said, I hope that's not just my children and my grandchildren, that everybody realizes that European Jewry that came over in my generation contributed an awful lot to this country and did not take advantage of anybody. I think that is what I'm very proud of. I look at some of the different cultures that come over today and demand, and my taxes have to pay all these people that kill people in the street, and I have to be afraid to walk out. And I wonder, and I still say that we were brought up with so much. I remember when I was young, when I was 16, 17, and came here alone, I would always say it's better for me to walk in familiar path. I don't want to try anything else. I was had too happy a childhood to alter it. So I thank you for giving me the opportunity to tell you all this.
And we thank you too.